Well, first let me say hello and a warm welcome to all of you for joining us today. We're so excited to have so many people here and to be a part of this work that Special Olympics is starting to take on. My name is Annalie Steven. I work for Special Olympics International on the Global Community Health Program. And it's my pleasure to be able to be here with you in Vancouver today and working with Special Olympics British Columbia. So before we jump into the agenda, I just wanted to do a few housekeeping things. This room is where we'll be all day today. There is coffee in the back, so if you would like to get up at any point and get coffee, please feel welcome to. We have one break that's scheduled mid-morning, but please feel welcome if you need to use the restrooms. They're just outside the door, and please feel welcome to get up and move as you need to. There is not Wi-Fi in this room, and that actually I think is quite a nice opportunity for all of us to just be present here with one another today. So if you haven't already, please silence your cell phones, and we'll get into the start of the day here. So today is kind of a new thing for Special Olympics. I think most of you are familiar with Special Olympics as an organization and the work that we do in sport. Probably some of you are familiar with the work that we do in health. And we typically come to partners and ask them to do things for us. Come be a coach with Special Olympics. Help volunteer with our athletes. Come do a fundraiser with us. Today's a little different. Today, we want to talk about a big issue that's going on in our communities that's bigger than Special Olympics. And it's about the health disparities that people with intellectual disabilities face. And we bring you here not because we think that Special Olympics has all the answers, but because we think you have the answers, and collectively, we may be able to do something together to change what's happening in the world. So we're hoping that you're here because you're unwilling to accept the status quo, what's going on with the health of people with intellectual disabilities in our community, and because you want to come together and start to work to tackle the issues that are happening to British Columbians with intellectual disabilities. They have lower life expectancies. They live more sedentary lifestyles, are hospitalized more frequently than the general populations. And if we can come together, I think that we can enhance the lives of people with intellectual disabilities through their health. So a couple of things to frame our discussions. We would like to have a focus on the big picture. So there's lots of different types of intellectual disabilities. People with Down syndrome, people with autism. We want to think about the big picture. All people with disabilities. And so as we have conversations throughout the day, you may bring up specific examples from your work about a particular type of intellectual disability, and that's fine to frame the example that you're giving, but just remember that we're trying to think about all intellectual disabilities together collectively as a whole. And in the same way, we're also probably not going to have time to go into depth into one particular type of health issue, like dentistry or mental health or pharmacy. We want to think about the big picture of health for people with intellectual disabilities. And again, that's not to say that as we have conversations, you're not going to have specific examples from your work in dentistry or in mental health that you want to bring forward into the conversation. But let's just keep in mind that we're trying to think about health holistically for people with disabilities. This is a big challenge that we're looking at together today, health disparities for people with intellectual disabilities. And we don't think that any one group can fix this on their own. Special Olympics, I think you know us as a sports organization. We provide sport opportunity to people with intellectual disability throughout the lifespan. We're an international organization that has almost every country in the world have teams that are participating. What you may not know about Special Olympics is we're also the largest public health organization for people with intellectual disabilities. And that started about 20 years ago when we launched a program called Healthy Athletes. Healthy Athletes is a screening program. We bring in volunteer professionals to competitions and games. And they offer free screenings to our athletes. So we have special smiles, which Carol is somewhere here in the audience, is one of our clinical directors. There's Carol. And they do free dental exams for athletes, give them mouth guards, fluoride varnish. Our opening eyes program, they do a full vision exam. And if the athlete needs prescription glasses, they have the equipment to grind the lenses on site. Athletes walk away with a free pair of glasses that day. And so that program has been incredibly successful, both in screening athletes and finding underlying health issues. We collect data from all of those events in the same way, everywhere all over the world. So we've also put together the world's largest public health data set on the health of people with intellectual disabilities. And that's how we've started to know about the big health disparities that people with ID face. So about 5 years ago, Special Olympics said, you know, doing these health screenings is one thing, but we really need to be doing more. When athletes come to us and we find an issue at a healthy athlete event that needs treatment, it's not enough to educate them about what that issue is if we don't know that they can go back to their home community and receive that care. So we need to start working with our communities to find out how we can make referrals that athletes can actually go and access that care. We also don't think that health should just be one day when they come to an event at Special Olympics at a healthy athlete tent. Health needs to be around. So our Healthy Communities Project look at how we can bring health into every aspect of Special Olympics and make it a year-round piece. So I tell you those things just to frame up a little bit about why Special Olympics and why we're convening this meeting today, where you may know us more of as a sports organization, but we're also involved in health in many ways. And we believe that our athletes can't compete at their competitive best if they aren't healthy. If they can't hear the starting gun or see the finish line, if their feet hurt when they run, or they have pain in their mouth or an infection in their body, they're not going to be able to compete at their best. If they're overweight or obese, they're not going to be able to run as fast or swim as fast as they could if they were at a healthy weight. So this deeply ties into the movement of Special Olympics and the work that we do. But as I said earlier, we can't do this alone. The health disparities that our athletes face are not things that we can simply solve by screening through healthy athletes, by providing ongoing wellness opportunities. If when they go back to their communities, they don't have the same access as the general population to healthcare resources, if they aren't able to lead healthy lives. And so that's why we invited all of you here today, to have this conversation together, to say, what can we do collectively as a community to start addressing these health disparities? So we need individuals. We need the government. We need universities. We need researchers. We need our athletes to tell us what's going on in their lives. We need all of you if we're going to do this. We can't do it in isolation. We are also, I think today as we have our conversations, we need to be thinking about two things. The first is, what are the quick wins? What are the things that we could leave here today, make a small change, and have a small improvement in our communities for people with ID? I think those will be easier to come up with as we have the conversations throughout the day. The other thing that we need to think about are the larger pieces. The systems changes, what's going on that's going to take collective effort to start to address. So keep both of those things in mind. Later today, we're going to have some questions that we'll get a chance to talk about as a group. So think about those two perspectives. What are the quick fixes, and what's going to take longer collective work to accomplish? We think if we do this right, people with intellectual disabilities are going to live longer. They're going to be active. They're going to have more fulfilling lives. And we think that it's going to save our healthcare system money, which is always, people always like to hear that. So I also wanted to point out that we have a lot of diversity here in the room today. If you open up your packets, you'll see a list of the attendees who are here. We aren't going to have time to go around and have everyone introduce themselves, but just to give you a sense of who's here and what agencies are represented. You're also in that packet going to see a couple of documents. One is a survey. We're hoping to get some feedback about this day, how successful it was for you, what you liked, what you didn't like. And the other is I guess I'm going to call it a commitment form. What is it that you would like to commit to taking action on and working with us together on in Special Olympics? And we'll get to those in a little bit before the end of the day. So I think the next thing I'd like to do is show you all a video, which is of Tim Shriver, who is the chairman of Special Olympics International Board. He's also the son of our founder, Eunice Kennedy Shriver. And this video was taken a few years ago at a talk that he did in Connecticut, but talks about why Special Olympics and the work that we're trying to do with health. So
we went and did our own report, and we found doing literature reviews from around the world, life expectancy 10 to 20 years less than average people, disproportionate rates of heart disease, cancer, diabetes, cerebral vascular disease, 30%, less than 30% of people with intellectual disabilities, as best we could determine, received care from a medical specialist. And we showed this report to then Surgeon General David Satcher. And he commissioned on the spot the first ever Surgeon General's report on the health status of people with intellectual disabilities. He published it on his last day in office, and this is what he wrote. As a society, this is the Surgeon General of the United States, not of Tanzania, where the health care is minimal. This is the United States. As a society, we have not been listening to or paying attention to people with intellectual disabilities. We have been too likely to expect others to speak to their needs. We have found it too easy to ignore even their most obvious and common health problems. Just as important, we have not found ways to empower them to improve and protect their own health. No one who cares would suggest that health care in the United States for this population is acceptable. No one would suggest that this is acceptable. A couple years later, the United Kingdom did a report similar. I can't hardly say the title without wincing. The title of their report, issued by their Office of Healthcare, Death by Indifference, chronicling massive numbers of lost lives due to the indifference of the healthcare system. And we looked at the two of them and we said to ourselves, why? First, let's be honest, people with intellectual disabilities are seen as a low priority. That's the truth. We ought to face it. Second, healthcare professionals report they don't know how to care for this population. Pediatricians do, in general. Everybody else will say, in wildly disproportionate numbers, they don't know how to care. And so they put up the walls. Third, money. You don't get the reimbursements. You don't get paid as much. Takes more time. People don't want to deal with that. Fourth, they don't understand the capacity of people with intellectual disabilities. Don't see them as people of value. Fifth, they don't see the needs. They don't understand the special health care needs of this population. And after all those things, you can say there's a less charitable view. And I heard it straight from one of our doctors. I said, how can this be? Where's the problem? He said, Tim, it's simple. He says, people come in to the doctor's office, and if they have an intellectual disability, they get a quick and dirty. Quick and dirty? Yeah. Oh, yeah. He says, you know, look, they're coming in for an eye exam. They're not operating a car, they're not operating heavy machinery, they're not a lawyer, they're not reading documents. You get them in, you check their eyes, you give them a pair of glasses, you get them out. Move them through. He closed by saying, I'm not proud of my profession, but that's the way it is, a quick and dirty. We saw an athlete just this past summer at the Healthy Athlete Screening Center in the United Kingdom. He'd seen a doctor 9 months before. He had an advanced undiagnosed glaucoma that would have blinded him if the doctor there at the Special Olympics tent hadn't taken the time to really give him a thorough exam. So he had seen a doctor, and the doctor had given him, in effect, the best we can say is a quick and dirty. So how is this possible? Haven't we changed this? Isn't that over? Didn't we close institutions? Didn't we move people into community living? Didn't we open schools? Didn't we open opportunities to people in employment? Well, apparently not. Apparently not. So I would want us to say that we're in the midst of a human rights, a civil rights struggle for health care for people with developmental disabilities. It's nothing less than that. It's not going to happen if we continue to treat it as though it were just a simple small problem, just the problem of one family, just the problem of one syndrome, just the problem of one diagnosis. We have a civil rights problem. And when we face it that way, and it's not about them, as every civil rights struggle is not about somebody else. Civil rights struggle of African Americans was not about African American people, it was about the country. Civil rights struggle of women or other groups wasn't about women or isn't about women. These things are not over, by the way. It's about all of us. It's about what we need to do as communities, as cultures, as systems of caregivers. So this struggle is also about all of us. It's not about Billy Quick. It's not about Jennifer. It's about me. It's about what I'm doing. You can't have discrimination and exclusion if somebody's not doing the discriminating and the excluding. So we have to recognize that we have to rethink the potential of every person. We have to remember the lesson I believe my mother learned many decades ago from her sister. Dignity is not an achievement. Dignity is not something you earn. Dignity is what you start with. The quality of access to quality care is something everybody gets at the beginning, not as a function of what they earn. It's not something their accountant gives them. You don't get your health care. You don't get your value as a human being from your balance sheet, from your checkbook. Special Olympics as a movement is committed to giving everybody the chance to be a great athlete, but you can't be a great athlete if you're not a healthy athlete.
So thank you, and now it's my pleasure to introduce the CEO of Special Olympics British Columbia, Dan Howe.
So I'm the one who harassed all of you, got you the emails, the phone calls, where are you? I apologize. Today, in a lot of the things that we're going to be talking about, we're going to be showing you research from around the world. And part of the reason for that is we couldn't find the research here. It doesn't mean that it doesn't exist for BC individuals, it just means we didn't find it. So you may have other sources, and that's great if you can let us know. But the one thing that we did find is when we could find data on BC individuals and compared that with data from around the world, it was very similar. That it wasn't wildly disproportionate. We could look at it and say, you know, that's very, very close to here. So we are making some inferences today, but it's based on that kind of data. So one of the things that Tim talked about and one of the pieces of information, there's a couple of studies out there, and they have different years behind them. One says if you're a male with an intellectual disability, you'll die 13 years earlier. If you're a female with an intellectual disability, you'll die 20 years earlier than somebody without. There's other studies that say if you're a male, it'll be 10 years, or 11 years, or 6 years, or something like that. But in every case, anybody who's studied this has always looked at it and found that if you have an intellectual disability, chances are you may die earlier than somebody without an intellectual disability. And when they looked at that, they started to try to determine why. And there were two things that came out. The first one was a lack of exercise, a lack of involvement. And World Health suggests that every individual needs at least 3 hours of exercise a week. If you're a child, you need an hour a day. And that's consistent with what other organizations are saying. Yet when we look at people with intellectual disabilities, they're not getting that kind of exposure. So therefore, we see the discrepancy there. The second thing that happens is that people with intellectual disabilities, or anybody, for example, you need to eat healthy. And one of the studies said that only 7 to 8% of people with intellectual disabilities actually eat a nutritious diet. So therefore, we have two things that we can control, or that they can control, activity and diet. And if we can control those, if we can increase the activity level and decrease the amount of bad food that they're eating, they will live longer, they will be healthier, they will be more productive in their jobs, they will be better athletes, and BC will have the best athletes anywhere around, which is what we're hoping for. In terms of the obesity and overweight issue, when we're looking at that, it affects a couple of things. It affects their life expectancy, but it also impacts many other diseases like cancer, like diabetes. It'll have a major impact on those. It'll also affect their quality of life that they have, and through that, we're not doing them any favors by just pretending it doesn't exist. We have to get active on that. There's also, as Annalise said, there's also the cost saving to the medical area and the amount of people who have an intellectual disability who their symptoms are treated with drugs and to control behaviors, to control other things. Well, those drugs, in many instances, also affect their weight. So in one case, we may be controlling a behavior, controlling something, and using a drug to do it, and that in itself may affect their weight and cause all kinds of side effects. So what we're trying to do sounds really simple. Let's just get them to eat better and exercise more. But it's not that way at all. When we look at somebody with an intellectual disability, we have to motivate that person to exercise. And all of us in here know how hard that can be. If we were to say, we're all gonna go outside right now and go for a run for the next hour, I think I'd hear a few excuses of why that wouldn't happen. We also, in addition to having to motivate them, we also have to motivate their caregivers. If they live at their, if they live with their parents, we've got to motivate them, because quite often it's those people who will provide the ride if they need the ride, who will provide the motivation to get out there, help them with their schedule, whatever. If they live in a group home, that becomes a little more difficult, because quite often in a group home there might be 3, 4, or 5 people who live in that place. And what we've been told by some of the athletes is that they want to participate in a sport program, but the other 2 people in their group home don't. So nobody can go. Or they've been said, we all want to go, but the staff who's on that night doesn't like sport. They want us to watch something on TV that they like. So there's all of those kinds of issues that it's not just necessarily we got to motivate the individual. We have to motivate the individual. We have to motivate their caregiver. And again, that's not always easy. Then there's the issue, especially outside the Lower Mainland, where transit is not easily accessible. And so if the caregiver is not prepared to drive, then quite often, because of where we can get our facilities, they may not always be on a bus line, they may not always be accessible by public transit at that time of night, so it could cause all kinds of problems with that person getting there. So let's assume we got everybody motivated. And let's assume that we could get them out as Health Canada and WHO suggests 2.5 to 3 hours a week, or if you're a child or youth, 60 minutes a day. Then we have to start talking about, well, it's not just one day a week, it's 3 to 4 days minimum that we have to look at that. And then, that makes it a little bit different, or a little bit harder to motivate, because many parents also have other children, so they're trying to fit their schedules in. And so it becomes a very, very difficult thing for that to happen, because quite often many of our individuals in our programs rely on somebody else to help get them there. So you have to be committed to get there. Then it gets further complicated by some of the individuals can't afford it. So Special Olympics, we don't deny people because they can't afford it, but if they don't want to be part of Special Olympics, if they want to go out to the rec program, or if they want to go out and join minor hockey or minor basketball or something like that, then those can be pretty expensive. So some of the individuals may not have the ability to play those sports. Then on top of that, there's not always a program available for them in their area, or there's no facility space. So we have some programs that we're running that are completely full because we can't get any more facility space. If we could find more coaches and run another night. And then when we look, so that's the exercise part. Then when we look at the nutrition part, Not everybody with an intellectual disability gets to choose what they eat. So we had one athlete come to us, and we were trying to figure out what they ate. And they said, well, the staff gave me a bunch of boxes of Kraft dinner, and that's my meal for this week. I just make a different box every night. And they said that that was fairly consistent. Now, that doesn't happen everywhere, but when you look at the data and it says 7 to 8% of the people eat nutritious meals, it's happening more than we think. And that's a challenge. So we can't get healthier if we're not fueling our body properly. We also have to change behavior. So for example, bowling is a huge program for people with intellectual disabilities. It's been around for long before Special Olympics. That was one of the first programs that people started for people with intellectual disabilities. Now, if you've ever gone to the bowling alleys, when there's individuals playing, it's usually a couple of things happening. One is, it's not a highly aerobic activity. They get up, they walk to the lane, they throw the ball down, they come back, they give somebody a high five. It's not a lot of activity there. That's not going to change a lot of behavior in terms of losing weight. Secondly, it was fairly consistent when we looked around that they would come into the bowling alley. The first stop would be to get their shoes. The second stop would be to go over to the little store area, get a soft drink and a bag of chips, and then come down to the floor. So again, here we are trying to put a program together that will help them lose weight and everything like that, but actually we're contributing to the problem. Now, the social aspects and all of the other stuff that they get from that is very important. So they're getting all of those types of things, but there's ways we can work that they can also get the other benefits. And so what we've started to do at our programs is you can't have the soft drinks, you can't have the bags of chips during the programs. We encourage them to drink water there. A lot of our programs now are doing a warm-up before where they're putting some music on and getting everybody out there moving and stuff like that as a way to get some activity going, because they know the activity itself is not a highly aerobic activity. So we're trying to work in those kind of ways. Thus, we have to make meaningful change in some of the things that we're doing. And it's not just token change. So it's got to be, we've got to change behavior. We've got to change the way we motivate people. And we've got to change our expectations. And we're finding that when we change the expectations, when we provide the information, when we show people what's possible, people with intellectual disabilities far exceed what we thought the potential was. And we have some amazing people who have come out and through all of that, showing us that they can stick to a plan, that they can change from drinking soft drinks into drinking water, and that they can lose 50, 60, 70, 80 pounds and keep it off for a long period of time. And I think that's our challenge. How do we do that?
All right, thanks, Dan. So, now we're gonna have some time to have some discussion, because like I said, we see ourselves as the conveners today. We see that we have started to go down this path of understanding what's going on with the health of our athletes and other people with disabilities, but that we're not the experts who are gonna be able to solve this, especially on our own. We need all of you. So today we're gonna have a lot of time to think together and to talk together and see what kind of solutions that we can do. But before we do that, since this is we've been talking a lot about physical activity, and we want to get your brains moving and your body's tied to your brain, let's all stand up for a minute. And we'll just take a moment to stretch. So what I'd like you to do now is to share some of your thoughts with the group. If you could stand, or if you would like to speak, I forgot to mention at the start of the day that we're recording this session. So Mike up here in the front has been recording me for most of it. Now he's got it out to you. But to be able to pick up the audio, we actually need to have you hold a microphone in your hand when you speak. So we have two lovely assistants here who can bring a mic to you. So if you'd like to share, please raise your hand and we'll have somebody find a mic for you. But first, let's talk about what the barriers are and ideas that you have, either for we being me as an organization or me as an individual or we collectively, how do you think we can start to solve some of these things? Yeah, right over here. So if you can just say your name and who you're here representing.
Hi, I'm Jay Cooper. I'm from Comox, BC, and I'm one of the athletes from there. One barrier that I've noticed and sometimes I have trouble with is transportation to the various events and sports that we have going on. I guess one possible way of fixing this is maybe carpooling if there are volunteers available, especially if there's multiple people going to the same event. Or I guess finding a good meeting spot for multiple people and then taking, like, say, a bus or a van to those different events. Yeah, that's what I have.
Great.
What I've got.
Thank you, Jake. Give him a round of applause. Right in front of you, Ashton. There you go.
My name is Tina Dam. I'm from Inclusion BC. I've also worked at agencies as well. And I recognized that some of the people that I worked with were using really abstract terms in regards to being healthy and more active. And that's pretty abstract, where one woman that I was working with, she was really picky with who she worked with, right? She knew exactly who she wanted. And when we started to talk to her about the fact that if she ended up gaining more weight, I wouldn't be able to work with her. Lucy wouldn't be able to work with her. That is what ended up motivating her. And it also kept the framework better for the staff because sometimes it was just easier to give in to all of this. So sometimes I think we need to end up looking at a less abstract motivation for people. Presently, I have a friend who has Down syndrome and has had lots of health issues, is pretty overweight. And right now we're talking about the fact that he's fallen in love. And let's live longer for his girlfriend and be healthier for his girlfriend, and that has really resonated with him. So I think we need to look at less abstract motivations.
Wonderful. Can I ask a follow-up question to that? So getting to the question about resources that exist, does your organization have anything, printed material, trainings, resources about how to do that, that are things that could be shared with other organizations? Can you hold the mic again?
They don't. The agency that I was working for was Spectrum. Very person-centered. Managers were trained in that way. It did take a thought process to end up doing that. So it's back to that person-centeredness. And the fact that I think all of us need to get less abstract. We talk about plain language all the time. So an organization called BC People First has some resources in regards to that. Inclusion BC also works with self-advocates, and they talk a lot about plain language. There's nothing in particular, but I think sometimes it just needs to be a bit of a mind shift, and you need to say it out loud.
Yeah.
As soon as you say it out loud, I don't know if there is training for it, but managers and agencies and supervisors, just say, what is that person's motivation for being healthy? Really think about it. Mm-hmm. Really, really think about it.
Great.
And try multiple times.
Thanks, Tia. We've got a question here, and then we'll go back to the, yeah, right here.
More of a comment to this.
Yes, okay. Go ahead.
My name's Sheila. Hello.
Hi, Sheila.
I'm with VIA Sport, and we've been participating in a process that helps implement the Ministry of Health's physical activity strategy. And so I come from the sport world, and we talk a lot about physical literacy, which is helping people have the motivation, the confidence, and the competence to participate in physical activity. And what strikes me when Dan was speaking is I worked with this great cross-sectoral group with health, education, recreation, and sport, and not once did we talk about the unique needs of working with people with intellectual disabilities. And when Dan was talking about, you know, the caregivers and the important role that they play, we had identified the resources that are available to help train childcare workers or teachers or recreational leaders, but not people who are working in group homes and not caregivers of people of intellectual disabilities. So the good news is, I think there's lots of resources out there, but we need to bring the worlds together to help make them relevant for all populations. And I just wrote down BC people first and inclusion BC, and help build the capacity to really recognize the unique environment of people living with intellectual disabilities. So good news is there's a movement in BC and nationally around physical literacy and activity. Bad news is it's not in plain language, and it's not tailored for the unique environment for people living with disabilities or the people supporting them. Yeah. So thank you.
Great. That sounds like a great opportunity, potential there. In the back.
Hi, I'm from Richmond Society for Community Living, and that was speaking to that is easy read resources for people so they understand their rights, they understand, health information is presented to them in ways that they can understand. Because a lot of the caregivers that I work with, English is their second language. So they have barriers to be able to express the health benefits and accessing healthcare. And so I find that when we develop internal easy read resources, it actually benefits the caregiver as well as the individuals we support. So I was hoping that maybe I want more easy read, and I don't know if anyone has developed them, because I think it would be really great to be able to share them across organizations.
Up here in the front.
Hi, my name is Rita. I'm with the BC Healthy Living Alliance, and kind of in a unique position here because my husband works in a group home, actually. at the Healthy Living Alliance, healthy nutrition and healthy eating is a huge piece of our policy area, as well as some program work that we've done in the past. And my husband, when he first moved into this group home, found that the guys that he was supporting were making a lot of meals, but they were making a lot of pre-made and packaged food, high levels of sodium, high levels of fat. And so he brought in a lot of food skills and got them making a lot of fresh foods with ingredients and cooking from recipe books, and it's been a great activity. And now they've also developed their own garden, and so they're gardening, and that's also got that social inclusion piece, because they're talking with their neighbors about what they're growing in the garden, and so it's really really helped. But just in terms of BC Healthy Living Alliance, we do have some resources delivered by our members Canadian Diabetes Association called Food Skills for Families, and that's a cookbook and training which was originally developed for low-income people and people that otherwise have barriers to healthy eating. So I think that could be looking at training the people that work in the group homes, but also the participants themselves doing food skills could really help.
Wonderful, thank you. We've got one in the back. And then over here next.
Hi, I'm Estelle Dufresne. I'm here representing Dietitians of Canada, but I'm also in BC. And I'm also a parent of a 13-year-old with Down syndrome. And I think that we also have to take a step back. One, first of all, we have to create expectations of parents that their children can achieve these things. And so we always had the expectation that our child would read, that she would be active, that she would eat healthy. Now, it helps that both my husband and I are health professionals. but I think, so first of all, we have to create expectations and help to educate the parents, support the parents too. I mean, I knew all these things were important. Infant development program came, the physio came, gave us the program for the week. I was overwhelmed with appointments and trying to keep myself healthy and all of those sorts of things. If the infant development program paired with, let's say, UBC Physio and sent in a student volunteer 3 times a week, that helped my child get through those. Because everybody says, oh, you only need to do these three things in the morning. And physio tells that, speech tells you that, you know, all of these things. It's hard to fit all of those things in. So I think supporting parents of young children so that they establish good habits, also having access to the health professionals that they need. I had some questions in terms of texture and progression, and that wasn't my area of expertise. It was a long wait to get into the feeding program at Sunny Hill. You know, maybe there's need for more early interventions to support parents and to educate parents so that they can, in fact, get their kids off to a good start. Also, looking at health literacy, all of our children, if possible, need access to early reading programs, so that they can, in fact, learn to read. My daughter reads at grade level, and that's because, again, we understood the importance of that. Not every parent has access to that understanding or the support to do what they need to do. And so I think we need to look over the age spans, and rather than judge the parents on what they do or don't do, support them, and also look in the context of social determinants of health. You know, my husband has a good extended healthcare program. My child goes to physio once a week so that she has good core strength, so that she can go out on the basketball court at recess and play with some of the other kids. And then the other thing with that, too, is to make sure that schools look at defining exclusion as bullying, because if your kid is different, they don't get included in the activities. And so, you know, again, those are all important things, just some of many.
Wonderful, thanks. I think we have one at this table here and then up to Dan.
Hi, my name's Sandra Marquis. I'm from UVic. I also happen to be the parent of an adult with developmental disabilities. And I just want to follow up on what Estelle said, and I think this is also actually missing in the framework document, and that is really some discussion of the social determinants of health. It's very difficult to live in a healthful way if you just don't have the supports there in terms of income or housing or supports for social inclusion. And I think, you know, adults with developmental disabilities are currently receiving about $1,000 a month, and that just doesn't cut it in terms of having a healthy diet. Even if they live in a group home, it's the money is just not sufficient to cover that. My daughter has lived in a home support situation, and so she pays her $716 or whatever it is, and that really does not cover rent and food. So I think, you know, there's a huge issue of the underlying determinants of health, and these guys are really affected by those. They're probably one of the most vulnerable populations in terms of the effects that they feel from social determinants of health.
Thank you. I'll come to Dan in the front.
So I'm hearing two things. One, a longer term area that we need to work on, and it's around policy, and that's around some of the issues that come. We can't expect somebody to eat healthy if they don't have the funds to do it. So some longer term types of things that we need to work in cooperation with service providers, with government, everything around that whole area of policy. But I also hear some shorter term things around if we can simplify some of the language that we use to talk about health, then that will be a better thing, not only for the athlete, but maybe for the caregiver, based on some of that. But one of the challenges we have is how do we get that information into the right hand? So with Special Olympics, for example, we have a set group of people that we can get the information to, but we only deal with a small portion of the population. And so how do we then take it from those who understand or who are committed or are somewhat interested in the program to that wider audience of Every individual in the province who has an intellectual disability is getting this information. And we are stuck in that area, that we just don't know how to reach out to some people.
Let's see, I think, Carol, did you have your hand up? We'll go Carol over here, and then we're going to welcome Jake, one of our athletes, up to speak.
So, I'm Carol Yakichuk, and I'm a clinical director with Special Olympics through Special Smiles. And my day job, I work for First Nation Health Authority and manage the oral health program. And so I have a very oral health focus in my world. But thinking about the barriers, I've heard a lot of things that resonated with me, and you know, about literacy you know, Tim Shriver was talking about support for families and inclusion and all of that. And we heard about facilities, that, you know, it's often hard to get facilities. And I just wanted to, I don't really have anything to add to that. It's a very complex issue, and I see the long-term work ahead on policy and funding and support for people. But I wanted to share, you know, with First Nation Health Authority, what attracted me to that organization, maybe I should stand over here, was the fact that it is very much working toward a wellness focus, an upstream focus, and they see themselves as health and wellness partners for all their clients in BC, which is fantastic. And so I know that this would not reach every person with intellectual disability, but everybody is encouraged to develop their own health and wellness plan. And I see the use of technology here as something the Special Olympics could really foster and start to be able to share those kind of, to be a health and wellness partner and have maybe, you know, identify some streams, how to be more active, how to eat healthier, how to challenge, you know, our minds, and then have everyone work toward these personal goals. That's very client-centered, and it might be with a group home worker that the person is working, or with their family member. And on that particular part of Special Olympics site, you could then be starting to connect people to, you know, to parents, to raise awareness and to connect resources and do that whole other piece of work that's so important that we want to do. And Dan, you know, trying to work out of the box, get out of our silos, and how can we connect people? What about a conference once a year that brings together people who are caring for, our parents too, are working with individuals with intellectual disabilities, and then have a very targeted conversation about, you know, when everyone puts their heads together and their efforts together, how can we make change happen?
Great, thank you. We'll come up here, and then then Jake, you'll be up next.
So my name is Jean-Paul Collet. I am a clinical professor at UBC and working at the BC Children's Hospital. I am the representative of a large team with different anthropologists, sociologists, psychologists working on this area of children with neurodevelopmental problems and their families, and working in partnership with Special Olympics. I feel that I could share some information about what we do, because it could be a generic response to these two questions, diet, exercise, but also to other aspects like drug use or sexual activity in a positive way. We start from the fact that the situation in life, we talk about children, is very complex when you have a child with no developmental problems, because the child does not fit with the organization of the society. And the situation becomes complex very quickly, because there are multiple care providers, many questions, not many answers, and the system is fragmented, the information is everywhere, and it creates a huge challenge for the families. And very quickly, there is a kind of downward spiral where the child cannot go to school because, or going to school will be excluded from normal activities, because at school they are not equipped to handle well with children with this kind of problems. And the exclusion progressively creates a second disability on the top of the initial one, whatever it is, that becomes the most important one because the child does not develop. And it creates anxiety on the family, often depression. The couple has to go through big challenges. Often, you know, there is separation, financial issues. So it's very, very complex. And on the top of that, the complexity is never stable. It could be good for a time, and then complexity becomes high because something happened in the family. So diet and exercise fits with this picture. And I think they have to be integrated into this picture, because just touching diet, just touching exercise outside of this context will have a very big challenge to find a solution. So the two things on which we are working with interesting things to share is one approach which is personalized, which is called personal coaching with goal attainment scaling. So it's based on the personal goal of the individuals. So if the goal is, okay, we want to go on obesity because that's our priority, then we identify some strategies. And the strategies will be defined by the person, like, for a person, it could be less snack when I go to the boarding, or I'm doing less fat food when I'm at home. And maybe on the top of that, I could do more exercise, which is okay, good things for reducing obesity. But for each strategy, we define with the family in their environment how it could be implemented. So this is why we create a network of friends, supporters, helpers that could help for doing exercise or reducing snacks, etc. And altogether, we follow the child and see how the weight decreases and how successful are the different strategies. Maybe a reducing snack was extremely good. You can go to boarding, don't take snack. But maybe the reducing fat at home was not very successful. So then there is a reconsideration about this objective and then modification in order to reach better. And so it's a very iterative process, like continuous improvement at individual level in the personal context of the family. That's a key point, because if a standard approach will never work, given the difference in socioeconomic status, education, literacy is everywhere. And that's one component, which is a process. And the other component is called, we use TIES, the TIES Communication Network. Initially, it was a company developed in BC by parents of a child who had neurodevelopmental problems. And it was developed in order to help supporting the child staying at home. So it's a system that is managing networks. And now it has been bought by St. Elizabeth in Toronto for home care, and it's a not-for-profit organization, and they give very, very good price for that. The advantage of TIES is that the family can develop any type of network they need for their own support. So it could be the network of relatives, the network of friends, the network of, other kids with the same problems in another network. and there is communication within networks or between networks. And it's possible for everyone in the networks to download useful information, and everything is managed by the family. So they could refuse what is downloaded, to accept it, and to share it with others or not. So overall, the network is built around the family to support the family, and then it can be developed on ad hoc way, you know, one for exercise, for example, where we bring new people and we take the ones that are important in the existing network in order to facilitate the success of a specific goal. So that's the two together makes you know, a very active and vigilant system in which it's possible to identify early the problems and to develop actions very appropriate and targeted to the specific point. So that could apply to many of the questions here, because in fact it's a system which is flexible enough to handle any kind of barriers, because it's very granular and find the barriers at family level or at patient level.
Thank you. So I'm hearing a couple of themes, and Dan obviously had some as well. What I want to ask you to do right now is to come back to the notes that you made at the start of this conversation. The two big themes that I'm hearing here is that there are some incredible best practices that already exist here in your community about how to start addressing these issues for people with ID. And so part of it may just be elevating those resources so people are aware of them and starting to disseminate them more broadly. The other theme that I heard was that there are a lot of resources that exist outside of the disability community in the general community that our athletes and other people with intellectual disabilities can take advantage of if we can think about how to make them more inclusive. And so as you look at your notes, just show of hands, does anybody have ideas of things that fit into that sharing best practices idea? Is that something, a theme that's resonating with anybody's thoughts? A few. How about the promoting inclusion in existing programs? Was that in anybody's thoughts? A few more. If there are things in your notes that didn't get brought up in the conversation, what I ask is that you transfer them over to that feedback page that we have for you at the end, so that they're things that we get to hear and we can help bring forward into future conversations that we have. So we're going to switch gears just a little bit. It's my pleasure to be able to introduce to you Jake Hooper, who was the first one to get brave and stand up in front of the group today. So thank you for that, Jake. Jake is a Special Olympics athlete who lives in Comox. He's been a Special Olympics athlete for approximately 9 years, and he trains in swimming, track, curling, floor hockey, and is an athlete representative on the local committee for the Comox Valley. So please join me in welcoming Jake.
Hi. Forgive me, I'm a little bit nervous. Hi, I'm Jake Hooper, and I've been a Special Olympics athlete for about 9 years. I've attended two summer national games in track and field and one winter national games in floor hockey. I also represented Special Olympics BC at the Canada Summer Games in Sherbrooke, Quebec. I've been attending performance training camps for a couple years now and working hard to ensure my sports skills are where they need to be in order to reach my goal of representing Canada at the World Games. To do this, I know I need to be working hard on becoming healthier and more fit if I am to be successful. I need to have a strong core, ensure I have the endurance to complete my races, and I fuel my body with the right fuel at the right time. So along with my sports training, I've been training to be a healthy hero. I'm being given skills to achieve my goals and assisting other athletes in achieving theirs. Last spring, I attended a training track camp where we were in the sun for 8 hours. To make sure nobody went home looking like a lobster, I talked with athletes about how to stay safe, made sure everyone had sunscreen, and reminded them to apply it throughout the day. I also checked that people were wearing hats, everyone drank lots of water, and I also handed out lip balm and sun safety bracelets. I know that in order to perform well in competitions, I need to be healthy and stay fit. That way I can compete for many years and live a good and healthy life. There's still a lot of work for Healthy Heroes to do in getting this message to all of our athletes, which is why I'm going back in April for more training in this area. Thank you to everyone here for all your support of Special Olympics BC. Thank you very much.
Wonderful. Thanks, Jake, for sharing your story. We have another story that we want to share with you of an athlete and a parent. Kirk and Carson are going to tell their story about experience with healthy athletes. And I just want to frame this in your minds for a little bit about healthy athletes is our window into the world of health of their athletes. So that's why we're showing these examples. But we want to think more broadly than that today about the larger systems of care. And so you're going to hear some things in the video about those themes, about systems of care. And that's where we'll take the discussion going forward.
So the healthy athlete experience for us was, the invitation was there, and we thought that, Carson has had a great healthy lifestyle all his life, and we've been very proactive parents. We thought everything was just fine, but we wanted to support the cause. So we thought if we showed up for the healthy athlete screening, that it would encourage other athletes in the community to participate. So we weren't expecting anything. We thought this was going to be an interesting experience, but not really anything would come of it. And boy, were we surprised. So what basically came out was that Carson had cataracts, and we had no clue. And it's severe enough in one eye that the concern was there was permanent damage was being caused. I think that afterwards, in hindsight, some of our family practitioners were making assumptions about Carson's ability to read and not communicating that with us. And that wasn't the case during the healthy athlete screening. Everybody was open-minded and took as much time that was necessary and started to see something that nobody else had seen before.
They helped a lot.
We contacted our doctor, got a specialist, got a surgeon involved right away, confirmed the situation, and within about 6 months he had cataract surgery, and then corrective lenses. Carson didn't wear glasses prior, so and found that the cataract in his right eye was very, very minimal. It might be a year, and so far with follow-ups it looks like we won't have to address that one for quite a while. But the left one was severe enough, and even though he has had the surgery and it's corrected now, because of amblyopia, which is the brain's ability to still have enough elasticity that the corrected vision the brain can understand what it's seeing, that's a work in progress. So, the thing to other parents is don't leave it too long. You know, the sooner you get to this, the better your child's going to have.
So we're shifting gears slightly from thinking about healthy weight and into the healthcare system and the experiences our athletes have, other people with ID have. And to give some more richness and context to this discussion, I want to introduce you Scott Howe. Scott is the owner of Howe International Consulting. It's a business that involves a wide range of activities, including health for Special Olympics. They develop business training programs in the Mekong Delta, am I saying that right? An organization and to organize friendship hockey games in North Korea. Scott completed and wrote the framework document that all of you had a copy of and probably had in some of the pre-reading for the meeting today. So it's my pleasure to introduce to you Scott Howe.
So I've actually been in touch with a lot of you guys over the last couple months as I've been putting the framework document together. So before I get started, I just wanted to take the opportunity to say thank you to everybody who took the time to review it. I know it's quite a big document. And a lot of you out there really took a lot of time to consider it. And it was very helpful as I tried to pull together a final copy. So thank you for that. In almost every category, people with intellectual disabilities are in poorer health than the general population. So some examples of that: children with intellectual disabilities have a prevalence of psychiatric disorders at about 36%, and that compares to 8% for children without ID. One estimate is that between 39 and 68% of female children and up to 30% of male children will be sexually abused before their 18th birthday. And up to 40% of people with ID will be perpetrators of sexual violence during their lifetime. Ambulatory care sensitive conditions, also known as potentially preventable hospitalizations, which is generally seen as a nice kind of metric to assess the viability of preventative care. People with ID are three times as likely to be hospitalized for an ACS condition when compared to the general population. People with ID are more likely to have poor oral hygiene and periodontal disease than the general population, and are likely to have a higher proportion of filled teeth, extracted teeth, less preventative care, and increased prevalence of traumatic dental injuries. In virtually every other category, people with ID have significant challenges with hearing loss, plugged ear canals, and so on. But the good news is that a lot of this can be solved and that it might not take a lot of financial resources to fix the problem. So for example, in the Netherlands, one study found that of people with ID, at least 80% are taking one psychotropic medication. But then there was a pilot program in Kansas which used multidisciplinary teams who did medication reviews. And out of only 282 people, this resulted in 190 medication adjustments and reductions, 85 emergency room diversions, 134 inpatient diversions, and produced a net savings of $3.1 million. And that's with only 282 individuals. So if we think about how much that might actually be if it was expanded across the majority of the population, we're talking a significant amount of money. And it's something that could actually make the athletes and people with intellectual disabilities feel better and live healthier lives anyways. And if we can change the way that we treat people with ID from a reactive to a more proactive approach, research suggests that not only will their quality of life be better, but it will put less strain on the healthcare system and will save a lot of money. Thank you.
So I've said this before, but I want to say it again. I think we're trying to open your eyes to some things that are going on in our healthcare communities. And we don't think at Special Olympics that we have all the answers. But we think that collectively, we probably do when we start working with all of you in our community. So we're going to have time for another discussion. And before we do that, I want to get you all up again, because we are talking about being healthy. Great. You can have a seat again. So I hope what you're hearing isn't making you too depressed or too scared about what we're facing or how much it's going to take to change. I hope, but what I hope you're thinking is, this isn't right. This is an injustice. And there are things that we can do about it. And I hope that you're starting to feel like I can be part of the solution to this. This doesn't always have to be this way. So for our next discussion piece, and we'll do the same again, have you get out a piece of paper. But we have so much expertise in this room today around so many different topics of health. So you may have a particular area of expertise that you bring to the table that you know more about. There may be some of these that you don't know as much about. That's fine. But in thinking about what we know already, what we can do to share best practices, I'd love for you to just take a moment and think about what is it that you, either you individually or you as an organization or you even as a community, are doing that could be shared or built upon to start improving the areas of mental health, overprescription of medication, sexual health, sight, hearing, teeth, feet, regular, thorough medical checkups, and recognition of the specialized health needs that people with ID have. So we'll take a few minutes, take some notes for yourself, and then we'll get the folks with microphones back up and have a chance to have a group conversation. All right. So I believe that before the conference that Dan had a chance to talk to Johnny from Canadian Mental Health. Is Johnny here in the room? Hi, Johnny. Nice to meet you. Not to put you on the spot, but I know that you guys had a conversation specifically around mental health and some maybe aha moments that you had recently about, best practices or resources. So maybe we can start with you. I think Ashton has a microphone.
I guess this is the definition of being on the spot. So.
Yes, it is. Thank you.
Well, and it's great to be here, and nice to meet all of you. I'm Johnny. I work as the policy director at the provincial office of the CMHA, and I had a great conversation with Dan, and it's great to see mental health explicitly identified on your agenda. I've worked in partnership with many of the people in this room. In many ways, the mental health community has had a very shared struggle with folks living with ID. People living with mental health problems with or without ID have a mortality rate much of a similar kind, people dying 20 years earlier. And one of the other issues I think that Dan and I talked about was the idea that the fact that so much of our healthcare delivery system is so segmented that, Tim Shriver's comments there around the quick and dirty. Many people in the mental health community experience that piece. And physical health care often isn't considered in some of those similar ways. So one of the first things I wanted to say was an opportunity, I think, for synergy is a policy priority or policy frame. And something that my association is really embracing is this idea of parity. And what would it take for physical health care, of which there are many on the screen in front of us, to be much more on an equal footing with mental health care or intellectual disabilities care? And really what that means, I think, when operationalized is when you walk in to see a primary care physician, and it's great to see Dr. BC in the room, or you see someone else at that first point of contact, you have an expectation, an assurance that irrespective of whether you're presenting with gallstone pain or asthma or diabetes, or if you're hearing voices, or if you're living with an ID or something that isn't visible to the eye, that you have the same standard of integrated care. And I think we have a long road ahead of us from a policy and a practice perspective where we have an integrated frame where physical health is on an equal footing to both mental health and addictions care. So that's something I wanted to say first, is I think there's a policy opportunity here, and there's lots that we can learn from the work of what's happening here in this room at the Special Olympics piece. The other piece I wanted to frame before I start to talk a little bit about resources and how we might be able to help as an association that's been around for a long time on this and could be more inclusive on these issues as well, is there are a number of populations that I think we need to think about. And these are the populations who may live with an intellectual disability or a mental health problem or an addiction or any of those co-occurring pieces who are systematically more disadvantaged than others. So we've heard lots about the social determinants of health, but if we think about people who experience disproportionate social disadvantage, so people living indigenous communities, refugee newcomer communities. There are communities that experience disproportionate social advantage that we really absolutely need to keep front and center in our work if we're really going to take up that population public health level frame that I think only you're proposing here. So that's another policy frame I wanted to put in. I think on behalf of the association, whilst I'm in no position to commit resources, that's above my pay grade, I can definitely say that there are things that we have thought about that might be of assistance to really addressing the mental health component of this. So the idea of literacy was mentioned earlier. So we have a range of mental health and substance use literacy resources that have been written, and we've had some focus historically on intellectual disabilities that might be of help, because I think what we know is if people know, they can start to recognize symptoms around mental illness, so it might be feeling depressed or experiencing anxiety or using substances in a problematic way. As soon as people have that information, they can actually start to seek help. And so that's one piece that we can help. I think we can be a partner in grappling with stigma. So even though we had Bell Let's Talk Day last week and millions tweeted about mental health, that was one day of the year. And unfortunately, in the communities that we serve, seeking out help if you're hearing voices or experiencing depression or anxiety, there are still very invisible and very real obstacles around stigma and discrimination. And I think there's something we can learn from your community and vice versa around how we grapple with the effects of stigma and discrimination. And finally, it's clear, and the report that Scott spoke to, that study that he cited in England that around young children who are living with both a psychiatric disorder and a mental and an intellectual disability is an issue that's alive and well here. And so we have resources, but I think we have some work to do to understand if they are as inclusive as they could be to serve young people and adults with intellectual disability. So we have Bounce Back, it's a primary care intervention, it's coaching for cognitive behavioral therapy over the telephone, but written at a whole range of literacy levels. That might be something that we can look at. And we have a positive parent training program for parents with kids who are showing some of the early signs of behavioral difficulty, where some of that may be helpful, but we will have to check on the inclusion part. But I think the final word I'd say before handing the floor to others who have lots of other things to say too is, currently here in BC, 84,000 kids would meet the criteria of a diagnosable mental disorder. So this is research done by Dr. Charlotte Whittell. It's unclear whether how many of those kids live with an ID as well. But we have a 70% treatment gap. So only 30% of kids who have a diagnosable mental disorder in BC receive any kind of specialized treatment. And that's only people who meet the diagnosis. There's thousands more off the radar. And I would say if we had a 70% treatment gap for childhood cancer, there would be uproar. And there is currently no uproar around the 70% treatment gap around childhood mental disorders. And I imagine the ID community experiences very similar treatment gaps. So it's about the moral imperative behind complete inequity in access to care that I think we can join some forces around.
Wonderful, thank you. In the back, yeah.
My name is Dan Goldowitz. I'm the scientific director of an entity that used to be called NeuroDevNet and is now called Kids Brain Health Network. And I'd like to commend and congratulate Dan and the Special Olympics for convening this group. That's one of the things that I think we do also very well is convene. You heard from J.P. Collette, who work with us to put together a physical activity and brain development conference. I'm not sure if any of you got to attend. It was in Whitby, Ontario, so a little bit east of us. But it was at the Activity Center. So this is something that we've sort of been talked about a little bit, is how to bring us together. There's an activity hub in Calgary, for example. In BC, I think the Special Olympics is an entity that could be Ability Center and Ability Hub, as opposed to disability. So something that that NeuroDevNet does very well, Kids Brain Health Network, is first, we're located at BC Children's Hospital, which addresses all of those bullets that you have there. And if they're not addressing us, there are people here from BC Children's, let them know, let me know. So that's one place to start. Another place to start is the convener part. So for example, Judy Illis, a professor at UBC who is in charge of the Neuroethics Core, led a Peter Wall Innovation Symposium exactly on overprescription of medication. And it was an exciting event. I think they're publishing a book from it, if it's not out already. The idea that somehow neurodevelopmental disabilities are managed through prescriptions versus interventions like JP talked about, Dr. Collette, I should say, is a really a grievance that we should have. It's a disrespecting of individuals with disabilities. And something that everyone has been talking about is what we call, from the medical point of view, is comorbidities. But I think Mr. Howe talked about that. We've all been talking about that. And that sort of points up an activist aspect of Kids Brain Health Network. So something that hasn't been mentioned is an example of kids with neurodevelopmental disabilities have about a 90% rate of sleep issues. Sleep issues are really huge because it's sort of spiraling downward. If a child can't sleep, the parents can't sleep, the family network gets stressed. And so to address that, Kids Brain Health Network is funding Better Nights, Better Days, which is a program put together by Shelley Weiss at SickKids and Penny Corkum at Dalhousie for an online course of how to improve sleep. And in this, they're rolling it out in kids with neurodevelopmental disabilities. So this is a bit of a pitch. If anybody knows of any families or kids that would like to enroll in this RCT, let me know. It's free of charge. You get these benefits. But that's just something, an idea that NeuroDevNet is supporting. And I'd love to hear, Kids Brain Health Network, I'd love to hear more from other people about things that we should be doing. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. I'm up here at this table. I think we have two questions side by side.
Hello, my name is Joan Rush. My issue is primarily oral health, but I would like to talk on a few issues. I'm a complimentary of your organization for bringing this group together. I do want to say, though, for the people who've spoken about having adult children with disabilities compared to children, my son is now 30. He's profoundly disabled with autism, and unlike the speaker who was so eloquent earlier about his Special Olympics success, my son does not speak or read or write, and if he was on the stage, he would be behind the red screen. So there are levels of disability that I think that all our discussions must take into consideration. What I do want to say is that I've heard from some of the speakers about services from Children's Hospital, and that my personal experience as a parent, and for that matter as an advocate, I was a director for a period of time of Community Living BC, I've been a director of service organizations, I'm a lawyer, my area is health law and ethics. I believe that you will never see better access to service, as frequently deplorable as it is in children's services. You will never see better access than when your family member or the person you care about or person you love is a child. The services will fall off a cliff. And it is, in my opinion, my legal opinion, systemic discrimination as they hit adulthood. And the gravest concern I have in the room, considering you're all activists, to be here, you are activists, is the use of the term long-term for policy, that we seem willing to assume that our arguments to improve access and service and financing will all be long-term. There has been much less strident advocacy, in my opinion, than there ought to be from all of our organizations, and particularly our advocacy organizations, towards proper funding. The woman next to me commented on the low funding to even properly feed and house individuals with defined disabilities so that they qualify for person with disability designation. And they have to be typically very disabled in order to meet that qualification. I couldn't agree more. It is not enough money to ensure a dignified lifestyle. But there's other systemic, academic, educational problems, much as Kurt pointed out, Kirk Busdeacon, in the film. People who are seeing and treating our children assume, especially as they age, that deficits in hearing, learning, oral health are simply part of their condition. And in the area of oral health, I think people should be aware that the Faculty of Dentistry, notwithstanding, it has a social contract to give back to all segments of society. As shockingly high as the fees are to train our dentists, they're probably a quarter of what we pay to train dentists who do not receive an hour of mandatory training in treating people with special needs in their undergraduate programs. So that people like my son could go to a dentist at Vancouver General Hospital, having been ejected at age 16 from Children's because they don't treat bigger people, to a dentist who would argue and tell me, I must understand people with autism just do that. They hit their heads for no reason. And we had to fight the system enormously to get care for a young man who proved eventually to have 7 teeth who needed root canal treatment, He lived with horrible infections. I've worked on, and you'll see outside, a couple of copies of a business case for a specialized dental clinic. We need a specialized dental clinic because some people are so profoundly medically complex that they can't go to a dental office in community. They must be under general anesthesia, and there's no room at the inn in our hospitals, progressively, even at Children's Hospital, for children with special needs. But even in community, I want to make one last point. Sorry to take so much airtime here. There is a program, the remnants of it, organized and run by Children's Hospital to allow children get more funding for dental than do adults, of course. But that program was intended also to cover some adults with complex special needs who need treatment under general anesthesia, but who were healthy enough to be able to be seen in general anesthesia clinics in community. But I've learned recently, while the BC Dental Association has pleaded for greater funding to have more of those clinics out there, originally there were 7 around the province, it's down to 4, all in the lower mainland. They mostly treat children, and the reason is because according to, and I've seen his letter, the chair of the board of PHSA, which runs Children's Hospital, said in response to the request for greater funding for those clinics, it doesn't matter that we could fund the general anesthesia. The dental fees paid by the province for people with disabilities at approximately 50% of recommended dental rates, because they've been frozen for at least 10 years, probably 15 years, but they wouldn't give me documents before that. They've been frozen for so long that the dentists will not treat the patients. They will not accept patients with disabilities because they're so underfunded. Now, why are we quiet about that? I mean, and what has the chair of the board of PHSA done to argue on behalf of all of our family members who are paid half as much through our tax dollars to cover their dental care and oral health needs, as government, which also self-funds its own dental plan, pays themselves? They are funded for 100% of the BCDA recommended rates as they move from year to year, 4 to 6% increase, but they've frozen the plan for people with disabilities. It is stark discrimination. And I hope that as we talk about all these things, where my son was being sent for psychosis analysis, the assumption being he was psychotic to beat his head, that we're not failing to meet the needs of our family members and loved ones and the people for whom we advocate, because we're unwilling to stand up and say, not enough, the funding is not enough. Sorry, so now you know I'm mad.
Wonderful, thank you. I want to add a couple, I want to add a couple of pieces to that because you had some really wonderful points. So one of the things that Special Olympics is doing, I mentioned at the beginning, our Healthy Athlete, Healthy Communities programs being across the world. So one of the things that we at Special Olympics want to see globally at Special Olympics International is a tipping point in the health for people with intellectual disabilities where we don't see the disparities compared to the general population. So does that mean that every single athlete or every person with ID is gonna be at a healthy weight, is gonna have no unmet dental needs? Probably not, but we would love to see them not be at a disparity to the general population. And one of the ways that we see that we can do that on a global stage is by activating communities across the globe who are working on this and then connecting them with each other so that they can learn best practices from each other. And so that comes back to Special Olympics being a convener. So with that in mind, I had a couple of examples that came to mind from the US, from things that you're talking about there. So the first is about medical school education and dental school education for people that they're not getting any training on how to work with people with ID. So in the US currently we have it's a organization called the American Academy of Developmental Medicine and Dentistry. It's doctors and dentists together on the same professional organization. And they are currently working over the next 3 years to get 12 influential medical schools in the US, you know, the Harvards and the Stanfords, the big names in medicine training, to sign on to change their curriculum and introduce training for doctors and specialists on how to work with people with intellectual disabilities. And they're also working with the organizations that provide the testing, so you, the tests that you have to take to get through medical school, to make sure those questions are on the exams, because they know if they don't have testing in addition to curriculum, it's not going to get taught, it's not going to get focused on. And so the idea there being, if you can get the most influential schools to do it, the rest of the schools are going to say, well, I don't want to get left behind, that we're not teaching this as well, and that that might create a tipping point in education. So something to, if that's of interest, to keep your eye on in the US, and maybe something that we can help replicate here in Canada as well. And the other being around reimbursement rates. Again, this is something that the American Academy of Developmental Medicine and Dentistry is doing in the U.S. We have a designation in the U.S. called medically underserved populations. It's usually for people who live in urban settings, are racial or ethnic minorities, or living on Native American reservations. And they get a special designation as a medically underserved population, which does two things. First, it means if you're a clinic that treats people with who are considered medically underserved, you get a higher rate of reimbursement for providing care to that population. So it provides an incentive for clinics to actually provide the care to the people that need it the most. The other thing that it does is it provides loan forgiveness for people who come out of school and work in clinics that serve those populations. So, people coming out of medical school have huge amounts of debt in the US and often feel like they can't go into serving the populations that they would like to serve because they can't afford to pay their loans back. So having that type of reimbursement that exists for them for going in and working with this population. So we're, through a partnership with AADMD, working on trying to get people with ID recognize that status so that those two benefits would kick in. I don't know, not as familiar with Canada and your systems, but there may be parallels there as well in advocacy that could be done on a shorter term basis. And I'm really glad that you pulled out the point that advocacy does not always have to be the long-term solution. There may be wins that if we bring our voices together, we can achieve in relatively short amount of time. So thank you. And then, yeah, go ahead.
So what I had to say was actually a follow-up to what you just said, and that is in BC there are, the majority of the medical system is fee-for-service, but there are also doctors on salary, and my experience and my opinion is that the fee-for-service is just not working for people with intellectual diabetes. I'm also a dietitian. So My daughter, for instance, has a good fortune to go to a clinic where the doctors are on salary, and it's made a huge difference in her healthcare. And I think we need to be advocating for more of that in the short term for vulnerable people, because she can go in and she can see a doctor for a longer period of time. She can take the time that she needs to be able to explain what her problems are. And she's not being, you know, rushed out the door in under 10 minutes. So I think that's one shorter term solution, is to increase the number of doctors on salary. I also think that there, for a lot of things that are not major healthcare conditions, and let's be frank, a lot of our people that we're seeing have ordinary colds and flus and ear infections and all those things. They're not always major health conditions. So my daughter also sees a nurse practitioner for most of her medical care, and that works really well as well. So I think there are shorter term solutions that we can be looking at. And I do agree that I think the medical school and dental schools are really missing education components. I know that that's a huge issue. I'm just, even in nutrition, for instance, it's a huge issue. There's a big missing component for nutrition in medical school, and that's been an ongoing debate for decades. So whether our chances of getting developmental disability training in there, I think may be fairly slim, but I think that it's something that we need to continue pushing for. And I have to also reiterate, I think that the dental care in BC right now for adults with developmental disabilities is abysmal, and the fact that my daughter has to go in and pay for her dental checkup on top of what is covered is really shameful.
Thank you. We'll come back over here in the back, and then to this table in the center, and then Jake, I see you.
My name is Diane Feingood. I'm a professor at Simon Fraser University, and my academic interest is actually in complex adaptive systems and approaches to solving complex problems. But I'm also the parent of a child with a rare genetic disorder that causes intellectual disability and other comorbidities. And I say it that way as opposed to just saying I have an adult child with an intellectual disability, because we haven't said a whole lot. And in the first discussion, I was quite frustrated because there's lots of comorbidities that prevent individuals with intellectual disability from being healthy and active and things like that. And in fact, the analysis that was done before we came here seems to have ignored the notion that, in fact, many people who have a comorbidity with intellectual disability may not be able to be active or eat nutritious food for their reasons related to the comorbidity. So I think to get the attention of government, the analysis is going to have to be a little bit more focused and detailed in that regard. Because right now the argument, you know, you could just say, well, telling people to eat better and exercise more doesn't work for a lot of us. So it's even more challenging for individuals with a disability. And for me, in my own personal experience, in fact, my stepdaughter is always more healthy when she has a job, actually. So if we actually spent more time and focused on helping individuals with intellectual disability be contributing members to society and have a job, actually some of them will get healthier. So the threads are challenging. I want to pick up on the conversation around complexity, because clearly we all listen to this conversation or participate and we recognize this is a complex problem. And complex problems are not simple or complicated problems, they're complex problems. And the way we go about solving them needs to be quite different. So one of the things we heard from Dr. Collet that's really important in complex problems is that individuals matter. And we've heard lots of interesting stories here that the challenges for parents, they vary considerably in that regard. So we have to be focused, and I applaud the work that's being done at Children's to help support individuals with the challenges that they have. But from a systems point of view, we also need to think about the complexity of the system, and strategies to address complex problems tend to be convening But not just once a year, people who have the various components of what they can bring together and share and build relationships. Because what's really important is building the relationships and building trust to move this group of individuals or a larger group of individuals from where we are now, a bunch of, I'll call it slightly self-interested or interested in the bigger picture individuals, to becoming, I'll call it a community of practice, or how, as Margaret Wheatley, a systems thinker, says, a community of practice where not only our self-interest but the interest of the group is built on the trust that we build in working with each other. And then we become a system of influence when we've built enough trust amongst each other, worked together, found ways in which we can take our agendas and the things that we're working on, share them with others, bring what's in the healthy living community to the intellectual disability community, et cetera, et cetera. So convening not once a year, but on a regular basis, those who are strongly interested will build the trust that's needed in order to actually address many of these complex problems. So I think that's a really important strategy. And then the last comment I'll make is that we're seeing in the area of mental health, for example, youth mental health, that the strategy is that's starting to work and that the government is actually supporting, and that there is momentum both at the provincial and the federal level to address mental health issues, is making it easy to access wraparound services. So creating storefronts, and in BC now we have an organization called, it's called The Foundry. It used to be Integrated Child and Youth Mental Health Services or something like that. Anyways, it's a group that's trying to create storefronts where individuals who can't necessarily identify their own problem but feel welcome to go through the door and know that they'll receive support from a variety of things. Maybe their problem is that they're not getting along with their friend, but what the actual problem is, they need housing. You know, so it's a place where you can come, feel welcome, and then start to understand what the individual's challenges are. So maybe that's the kind of strategy we need to build for individuals with intellectual disability. More places where they feel welcome to drop in and be supported, and then begin to unpack what it is that individual and their family actually needs. And maybe we can learn from what's happening in the mental health area. These storefronts are not called mental health storefronts. They're called, and right now, the one we have in the Lower Mainland is the Granville Street Youth Clinic. So, anyways, thank you.
Thank you. Center table here, and then we'll come to Jake. And then I want to make sure I give you enough time still to have a break.
Stand over here, I think, so I can see everyone here. My name is Dr. Arlene King, and I'm the Executive Medical Director for Population and Public Health at Fraser Health. And I was going to say a few things following the other discussion section, but I'm going to actually build on a few of the things I was going to say. And one of the roles I have is I actually oversee the health equity and population health area within Fraser Health, and we're actually working hard at trying to look at how we best organize ourselves to deal with both health equity and diversity within Fraser Health. So this is quite informative for me in terms of that thinking that we're doing. I think one of the things that it's very important that you do is to increase societal awareness, both inside and outside of the health sector, of the health disparities that you've described here, because I don't know that really people are aware of the significant health disparities that are experienced by people with intellectual disabilities. And I want to say that one of my passions actually over the last few years has actually been trying to advance oral health in many sectors. So I hear what you're saying, and I'm sitting next to someone who works in oral health in Vancouver Coastal Health, and it's a completely, frankly, ignored area by the health sector. It's like people have a piece of tape across their mouth and we don't recognize it as being part of the human body. And so there needs to be a lot of awareness, and I think there's a lot of folks in this country that are actually thinking about that and how we can actually improve oral health generally across all groups, with a recognition that there are serious health equity issues related to oral health as well. My next point is, it's sort of related to this about what the health sector can do, and clearly the health sector has a key role. Being in a regional health authority, I straddle, as a public health physician, I straddle both the health sector and the non-health sector. So clearly the health sector, who are well represented at this group, have a very important role to play. But I would also like to remind you that 60 to 75% of the improvements of health will actually occur from the non-health sector. And that's why, and they're not represented much in this room, really. And I think thinking about the partnerships with the non-health sector, because they are all health entities. I've always told ministries that are not health ministries that they're health ministries, because they're so important to advancing the overall health and well-being of our population related to both obesity, healthy eating, physical activity, all of the various major public health concerns that we have right now. So partnerships with non-health sector would include transportation to encourage and promote active transportation, education, agriculture, finance. There's just a whole lot of other sectors that we need to be working with to advance health equity. There's no question. And I'm sure there's others, but I'm just going to give you a few of them. And I think that's the main point, is I think you're very well positioned in many ways, because I think you're pretty visible to be a leader and a very important and forceful partner in the area of trying to improve health equity. And I think joining in with others that are very interested in advancing work on the social, economic, and environmental determinants of health is really very important. So thank you.
Great, thank you. Jake, did you still want to add something? Well, okay.
I'll try not to take up too much of your time. Well, as an athlete, one thing I actually find very important about the overall health area is the Healthy Athlete Program, which we've been talking about. I've actually gone to it a few times already. It is really informative. It helps out a lot. And one thing I had issue with is getting eye exams for new glasses. The Opening Eyes program for the Healthy Athletes has helped me get through that, and has actually given me a couple pairs of new glasses. One thing I struggle with, and I'm sure a fair amount of people do, is like sunglasses. They're always a big issue with me, but the one time I was there, they were actually very helpful, and that they actually gave me transition lenses. So since I'm mainly a track athlete and I'm in the sun all the time, having the transition lenses actually helps out a lot. But overall, just all the programs in it has been really helpful. And one thing I'm going to try and do more often is encourage other athletes that I see to go and participate in the Healthy Athlete Program, because I think it'll benefit everybody in the long run if they actually end up doing it. And yeah.
Great. Thank you. Well, let me just say, wow, that was an incredible conversation. When SOI first came to SOBC and said we'd like to try this out, having a meeting coming together to talk about the health issues that are going on in communities and what we can collectively do about it, we said, well, it'd be great if you could get like 20 people together. And to see today, I think we are between 60 and 70 people here in the room today. It just tells me that you guys are so ready to do something about this. You have incredible resources, and hearing all of your perspectives today and the comments that you're making, I think you're really well positioned to do something collective and individually to start to address these issues, and so that's really exciting. So we have a few more issues that we get a chance to talk to about this later this morning, but I did want to give you time to take a break. We were having such a rich conversation, I didn't want to cut us off right at time, so we did say we were going to come back at 10 after 10. It's 10:06 right now, so let's... I'd still like to give you 10 minutes so that you can use the washroom, get some coffee, some fruit. Let's try to be back at 10:16, and we'll take it from there. So thank you. So I hope you've had a chance to stretch your legs, maybe talk to a colleague or two, and have a healthy snack from the table in the back. If you could please come back and find a seat, we're going to get started. So to start off this next segment, it's my pleasure to introduce to you Donna Billis and Paige Norton. Paige is a Special Olympics athlete who's involved in swimming, track, bocce, basketball, club fit, soccer, softball, golf, and speed skating. Paige will be going to the Special Olympics World Winter Games in Austria next month. Let's give her a round of applause. Where she will be competing in speed skating. Donna is Paige's mom, and you would think that it would take all of Donna's time, but she's also a volunteer who helps to build the programs in the Fraser Valley. She's the chief demission of the Fraser Valley team going to the Special Olympics BC Summer Games in July, and coaches speed skating and soccer. She's also the speed skating head coach for Team Canada at the upcoming 2017 World Winter Games. And when she's not doing all of those things above, she's also a nurse. So please join me in welcoming Donna and Paige.
So good morning, everyone. Firstly, I'd like to thank Dan Howe and Special Olympics British Columbia for inviting us here today and giving us this opportunity to speak. As a parent of a Special Olympic athlete with complex medical issues, I'm thrilled and encouraged to see the initiative Special Olympics BC is taking in addressing the many health challenges that our athletes and their families face. When our daughter Paige was born with Down syndrome and diagnosed with congenital heart disease, we were overwhelmed knowing the many challenges she would face in her life. With my background as a pediatric nurse and her dad having been a special education school teacher when schools were still segregated, we knew early intervention was the key to giving Paige the best possible chance to develop to her full potential, both cognitively and physically. We worked hard to fill her needs, and there have been many challenges, barriers, and frustrations along the way. And I think for us, we didn't know what we didn't know and felt at times that there was really no one there to assist us or guide us along the way. I've said many times family need a one-stop shop manual that lists all the services, the resources, and organizations available that we could access to give our children the best possible chance in their development. So many times our information came from other families who were struggling as we were. And I don't know how families without a medical background are able to navigate through our current system and have any success. Our daughter has been fortunate to have our support and our voice to ensure she develops to her full potential and maintain a healthy, active lifestyle. Being involved with Special Olympics gives her that. She will continue to have her family's support, and we will continue to advocate on her behalf as she ages. As a Special Olympic coach, sadly, many of my athletes don't have the support as they strive to live independently in our communities. For many, they fall through the cracks, are unable or unsure how to independently access the healthcare system and services. Many of our athletes never complain, so too often signs and symptoms of illnesses, chronic conditions go unnoticed. It's very difficult also for some of our athletes with an ID to be able to articulate to physician symptoms they may be having or even remembering their own medical history. Physicians then don't really have a full picture, so treatment can be reflective of that. And to be honest, sometimes no one is really listening. It seems at times the list of barriers is endless, be it financial constraints, impacting healthy food choices, not having a true understanding of good personal hygiene and how that can impact their general overall health and confidence, to name just a few. So I applaud Special Olympics British Columbia for their insight to the health challenges of our athletes and all individuals with an intellectual disability that they face. And I thank all of you who've come here today, because if we collectively can identify the challenges, the barriers, the issues, and collaboratively work together, take our knowledge and resources, and strategize a plan, the ultimate end result is longer life expectancies and healthy individuals, both mentally and physically. And that is a really, really good thing. So thank you. Now I'd like to introduce my daughter, Paige Norton, who I'm very, very proud of.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Paige Norton. I am 23 years old and a Special Olympics athlete. I love to swim, golf, speed skate, play soccer, basketball, and softball, even run. I think I love just about every sport there is. To be a Special Olympics athlete, you must have an intellectual disability. I never think of myself as having a disability, and people who know me think I'm pretty awesome. I just know you can do anything if you try and work really hard. You can probably tell that I'm a really good reader, but I was born with Down syndrome. Down syndrome is a genetic birth defect that can lead to health problems, developmental delays, and learning disabilities. It's kind of where everything gets mixed up, so it can affect many things in your body. It was born with low muscle tone. Mom says I was a floppy baby. It took me much longer to sit, crawl, and I was two before I could walk. I was lucky because my mom and dad knew that if they started programs early during physio, getting me in gym classes, and involved in sport, I would be able to improve my muscle tone. As I got older, I joined Special Olympics and worked really hard to improve my fitness and strength. Today, I am proud to say that I can leg press 405 pounds and deadlift 135 pounds. So I would say that I have improved my muscle tone. My biggest challenge was having been born with congenital heart defect. I was born with two holes in my heart, and both of my valves didn't pump properly. I had my first heart surgery when I was 5 months old, and many more procedures before I suffered heart failure and a heart open heart surgery at 3 and a half. Dr. Heman is my cardiologist. What a great name for doctor. Dr. Heman. He was a little happy with the surgery in that we're able to close both the holes, but the valve repair was not 100% fixed. This left me with leaky valves and the need for valve replacement as I got older. With artificial bells, they need to be replaced as your heart grows. So we knew that I would need more than one surgery before my heart stopped growing. The plan was to continue to check me every year, and as long as I wasn't in heart failure, we would wait to do the surgery. I became more involved in Special Olympics. It was a place where I really fit in. Over the next 4 years, I improved my fitness and health. Imagined how excited my parents were when I was 13 years old. And Dr. Heumann gave us the news that he felt I will no longer need open heart surgery to replace my valves. He felt due to all my sports and training and had improved my fitness and strengthened my heart muscle to the point that I no longer need surgery. I am left with another leak, but it doesn't stop me from doing anything. Where's the other one? I check in with every 2 years now, and he's always amazed how busy my schedule is. Special Olympics is a big part of my life. Not only has it improved my fitness, but it's given me many opportunities to compete, travel, and make great friends who are just like me. Special Olympics has given me confidence to be the best I can be, and I am proof that exercise and a healthy lifestyle can have a huge impact on your overall health. Thank you for having me, and let me share my story.
Thank you, Donna and Paige, for sharing your story with us. So now I'd like to introduce Lois McNary, who is the VP of Sport for Special Olympics British Columbia, and has been involved either as a volunteer or a staff member with Special Olympics for over 30 years. So she must have started when she was just a wee babe. Yeah, Lois.
It is interesting that I've been engaged with people with an intellectual disability for over 30 years now, and yet I'm only just starting to learn about some of the organizations in the room today and that they even exist. Furthermore, I'm hearing about some amazing programs that I'd never heard about and the amazing work that you're all doing in this area. And I think some of you've had an opportunity to hear about some of the things that Special Olympics is doing in health and our initiatives that we're looking at to support healthy living. Many of us work in this field full time, and we still don't know who's involved in this segment of the population, that programs are out there, what research exists, what resources exist, and what we can refer someone to. Now a caregiver who's trying to figure all of this out. Many have told us it is overwhelming to try and find the right information or the right provider. What about the individual with an intellectual disability who's looking, or the doctor, or the dentist, or a student doing a project? How can they be expected to find the best research, the answers to their questions, appropriate programs, etc.? Many websites we visited have stop smoking programs or eat healthy programs. If a person is lucky enough to come across them, they'll get the information. And as you can see, there are many websites that they can get the information from. So do we need to create our own content for these programs, or is there a better way? The framework document suggests a website specific to people with intellectual disabilities. Thus, there could be a section on activity and links to organizations like Special Olympics, Via Sport, or Parks and Recreation. There could be a section on autism with links to their programs, or Down syndrome. It could have the latest research, lesson plans for teachers wanting to get their students more active. Instead of all of us working in our silos, we could build something that made it easier for people to find these resources. It wouldn't be easy, as we would need someone to create and manage the website, someone to recommend research, content, etc. for it. We would need all of those links to the site to ensure that they had approved information relating to individuals with an intellectual disability. Would this work? Is it worth exploring? Or is there a better way to collect and share information? What role does technology have in our discussions today? How do we use technology to solve some of our challenges? The task before us is, how do we live knowledgeably so that athletes with individuals with an intellectual disability can live healthy?
And that segues beautifully into our next point of discussion, which is my cue that we should also do a mini health.
Getting into the questions that Lois has asked, there's so much information on it. This is such a rich dynamic community that you all live in. How can we collect and gather information, compile it into a user-friendly way? So just to kind of get a sense of where you're all at, but one of the things Lois suggested was maybe a common or shared website that where information is housed together. Just thumbs up if you think that's a good idea, thumbs sideways if you're not so sure, thumbs down if you think like, yeah, you know, this is really not the solution. So if everybody can just give me a general sense. Say thumbs up, thumbs sideways, mostly thumbs up, most thumbs sideways, and a couple down. Okay, so we've got some different thoughts on this. I guess let's start there since we don't have consensus in the room. Would a couple of people who are thinking that this is a good idea give us some thoughts on why they're feeling that way? Yes, here.
I'm not sure how So I mentioned I'm part of VIA Sport, and we actually have a partnership right now with Microsoft looking at leveraging a new technology. So you know Cortona that I grew up, or Siri? So it's this idea of using a back-end sort of integrator of information. And I love the way you phrase it, Lois. Like, it's around that sharing knowledge and how do we make it easier. And so what we're looking at is it may not be a website because they are hard to maintain, stay outdated, but it's almost like a search engine, and we're doing it specifically around accessibility and disability, visible and invisibility, and accessing it to resources. And we're just starting. We just found 140, and if you're not part of that conversation, you need to make sure that you are. But it's a prototype for using technology differently to put information in coaches, athletes, parents, and caregivers' hands. And so if that works, that could be an alternate platform for all of us to share information.
This problem is a universal one, how we solve it, trying some different approaches.
All right,
we'll get to Carolyn and to Yeah, I absolutely agree, and that's very exciting to hear. You know, I mean, there's so many technologies that are, you know, that were there last year, but what I'm hearing around the room in all our conversation is people saying that, you know, caregivers can't access care. You know, John is saying, if I wasn't a nurse, how would I know? So we need some way and to be able for people to find the information. And it can't just be technology, it has to also be through, you know, sharing information and this collaborative approach of everyone maybe meeting regularly to talk about that as well.
Thank you. We'll go to the back table over here.
Yeah, this Cortona and the search engine sounds really exciting. I just think that a lot of our population probably would even have a hard time. Like, my daughter has a significant speech impediment, so that might not work for her. But I wonder to what extent we can connect, like, with HealthLink. I mean, I think that, you know, and not necessarily expecting, you know, do we expect that? Does it have to be the provincial government that funds everything? Can there be some joint funding so that there is truly one-stop shopping? Because I'm in the same situation as, you know, like, we were able to navigate the healthcare system because both my husband and I work with it. I can't imagine anybody doesn't work in it who has a language deficit and then, you know, and then has any other sort of barriers. So. help people navigate.
So I think that's my question. Well, that right to the comments.
Oh, I was just going to say, Dr. Sully's doctor is not here today, but we're from the Down Syndrome Research Foundation. We've been working on a project, and seeing everyone here today makes me realize that yes, we've been just looking at Down Syndrome, but expanding that concept. So we first started with the idea of, you know, there's so many complexities in Down Syndrome to manage, and so many times those preventative health things are not done, lead to larger issues. So we first started talking about the idea of a clinic, then we moved to the idea of a virtual clinic, and what we've created now through Dr. Stocker, who's at Thai BC, but also BC Children's and UBC, is an e-learning module for physicians, so they can have training about Down syndrome, and it will also be, physicians in training, and then it will also be a tool for physicians, so they can easily access that information, you know, on a website. So I agree that a physical clinic and a place where people gather and expertise is gained is optimal, but there are also benefits, I think, of using technology so that there's a central place where people can go, and the, you know, the risk is that everybody's kind of reinventing the wheel, so just working together makes the awesome.
Just to follow up on that, the reinventing the wheel is the really devil in this all, is that in surveys that we've done, and now I'm wearing another hat, which is something that's spreading over the medical community, which is called Strategies for Patient-Oriented Research. I'm a co-director of one of the new ones called Child Life, which is all about brain development and helping kids with neural disabilities. And both in my life and Kids Brain Health Network and this one, there is such a demand by parents and families for access to evidence-based information and guide and so on, that we're always pushed in this direction, hence my thumbs up. And I'll just share with you one thing that we just encountered last week at our monthly phone call, and it's a website called Huddle. Has anyone heard of Huddle? H-U-D-D-O-L. It is for disabilities. It as we would be a nonprofit entity. It's free of charge. They provide state-of-the-art analytics for use. Their fellow, their CEO, Mark something or other. I think ultimately they need to have a sustainability model. And that would be getting as many communities together as they can, like ours here, and be sharing data, anonymized data, but how to push things forward for them. And they're funded by the federal government. So if anyone's interested in this, I'd be happy to share my ignorance with you all. That's a kind of entity that is not the reinventing the wheel, because you have somebody else doing it for you. And it's centered not in any particular disability, but across disabilities. So I think that's an important issue.
So there are a few folks in the audience that were thumbs down, and I'd be interested to hear your perspectives too, if you're interested in sharing, you know, whether you think that there are better solutions for sharing information.
So the reason I have my thumbs down is I've already had my own experience in trying to build a website that was really going to be useful to a large range of, in this case, chronic disease practitioners. And, you know, as was said, it's very difficult to keep these things alive and animated in a way that makes sense. So that's one comment. Second one is, listening to the conversation already, I've heard about three different websites talked about without actually identifying it. You're talking about different target audiences for creating a website. So beware of structural solutions. Let's understand the problem you're really trying to solve and then ask the question, what's the way to solve it? So I would advocate again for more opportunities to build face-to-face knowledge and recognition of who else is out there. You know, in the age of Google, you almost hardly need a website that consolidates other websites, because that's what I heard was the suggestion. You can find stuff by just typing the question and ultimately a little bit of work. So who's your target audience? What are you trying to achieve? And then how can you best achieve it? And I would contend, or my hypothesis would be that most of the problems you're trying to solve would be better solved by building those relationships instead of keeping people in their silos and connecting them virtually.
Thank you. Anything else anybody wants to add to the conversation around a website or some kind of central hub for information? Yes.
Thank you. The federal government, through Health Canada, maintains a large website, and our taxes pay for that. And I think it is perhaps fair to say that they have an obligation as the main provider of our healthcare. Some things that I think we could be offering back then to Health Canada. I researched and wrote that to the Federal Minister of Health, otherwise Minister Philpott, when I approached her on the issue of access to dental for people who need treatment under general anesthesia, because there's such a crossover between the medical aspect of anesthesia, the hospitalization, etc., whether or not they could assist in any way, and was told quite firmly, not at all. But that goes back. I encourage you to maintain your discussions with Minister Lake. This is a provincial matter. Provision of services provincial. But what I did learn was that when you go to the Health Canada website, there's a section talking about the importance of oral health to overall health. It even includes advice on the links that we now know exist between bad oral health and heart disease, diabetes, obesity, sometimes because of problems with eating, a variety of diseases where, but certainly pneumonia, which has been documented to be a problem for people who have limited mobility. And anyway, despite that fact and warning people to ensure they maintain their oral health, there is nothing anywhere else that you can find in Health Canada dealing with that issue. So I started going to the various boards and tribunals that advise Health Canada from under the Public Service Agency of Canada to see what kind of advice they were receiving. And I looked up the governance of every one of those boards. Who's on the board? Who's advising? Who's been? It's all available if you want to be as boring as I am and go to one of those agencies. And found that the answer was none. There was none. There were no people who had any background. There were many people who had background in children's services, and they were all medical. But no oral health specialists, no oral medicine specialists even, no dentists certainly, no expertise. So we've allowed, notwithstanding their acknowledgement that there's this crossover, we've allowed them not to address it. I believe the same thing exists for addressing the needs of individuals with disabilities of many kinds, but particularly intellectual disabilities. For one, they're not usually a voting group. Right? They don't make a lot of noise at election time. Not a lot of people can, but many don't, can't. And so it strikes me that both of our governments ignore. I did the same exercise for our provincial government and found the same thing. There is no expertise guiding them. So I believe that we should be insisting that the websites that deal with health that are maintained by our governments, federal and provincial, in the health, they should be ensuring this information is available, easily accessed, that they take it into consideration. And just one more point on that, and that has to do with Indigenous population. There are more people designated with persons with disability in the province of British Columbia than there are people designated as Indigenous. But as much as I absolutely know that we need to pay far more attention to the healthcare and oral healthcare needs of people who are Indigenous, nevertheless, they have one benefit that we don't have, which is that their health and dental, non-insured benefits, all the healthcare stuff that's outside of our medical care treatment and dental, is a federal program, and it's much better funded than is the provincial one. And so we, again, this is another example of a separation of service based on a label. It's not right, and we need to address that. We need to demand more advice. We need to demand that the federal and provincial governments pay attention to our needs, and that they provide more consistent documentation that we could all access.
So that actually segues beautifully into our next topic too, which is about research. So we know to make good arguments and to move forward in ways that we know are going to be impactful, we want to be data-driven, we want to be suggesting evidence-based solutions. And so the next question, and certainly we can come back to some of the questions about how we share information, is about how do we work with other researchers to get information that's usable and can be used by our stakeholders? We've translated it out of academic speak into common language. Specifically, whether anyone has examples of, from their work, ways that they've seen that done really well that we might be able to replicate, or ways that we can bring that into the work that we're going to be doing together. And we'll go to this gentleman over here, if someone could bring him a microphone.
Thanks. I'm Tim Stain from the Center for Inclusion and Citizenship at UBC. And just on your last point, we actually, all of our research, we do a plain language information on, like videos and sort of stuff. So if people want to see what accessible research looks like, they can go on our website and look up any of ours. So we work with self-advocates to translate all of our research into plain language access. So it's easily done. And there's tons of work on that being done in the UK and Australia. So there's lots of models. It's not hard, just a matter of committing to it. I just want to go back to your early point. Well, I actually want to go back to Joan's point. Do a little advertisement, actually, around the voting. Just an unpaid political announcement here. The Center for Inclusion, Citizenship, and Inclusion BC are actually launching this afternoon an initiative called I Am Voting, which is aimed at getting people with intellectual disabilities out to vote in the provincial election. And we designed a bunch of videos and information and worked with a team of self-advocates. So if you're interested in the voting issue, or your son or daughter or yourself need to get out and vote, have a look at that. It's called I Am Voting, and it's launching this afternoon. But I just want to go back to the information side and the website generally. You know, in my experience, it's not parents who struggle the most. Parents are really good at digging up information and talking to other parents. It's when they go to their health professionals that they often run into bigger problems. So I think the information strategy really has to target the professionals, the medical professionals, the structures, and help them understand. Because most parents I talk to would say, you know, I know she has this going on, but nobody listens to me. Or I get shuffled around here and there, or I get, you know, well, I don't know anything about developmental disability. You know, well, you know, just pretend the cold is the same as everybody else's cold and you'll be fine. So I think that educational piece and the information for medical professionals, and we do actually have something called Health Services for Community Living in BC. I don't know if anybody's here from there, which is a bit odd. We do have one, good. And we used to have a provincial medical officer that oversaw issues of intellectual disabilities in the Ministry of Health. And that was canned about 10, 15 years ago, so it might be an idea to try to get that position back in the Ministry of Health that can kind of coordinate those systems. So we've actually kind of gone backward. I mean, we've gone forward in terms of a lot of the new research and some of the new projects in terms of actually looking at conditions and issues. But structurally, I think we've gone a bit backwards, and that's partially the gap between community living and health. Anyway, so that's just my plea. Like, you know, parents have access to a lot of information. There's a lot of info globally. You know, I'd say Australia, the UK are way ahead of us in this, and there's great models to use in both those countries. But where people run into problems, in my experience, is when they arrive at the hospital or the medical practitioner and that side. So targeting parents again, I'm not sure is the best strategy.
Up in the middle table here, and then probably have time for one more comment after that.
Hi, my name is Kayla Ragusa-Miller, and I work at UC Children's Hospital in the dental clinic. I work with kids with special needs, and I just wanted to touch on actually what Tim was just saying, and I couldn't agree more because I am a parent of a special needs child, and the reason I developed my program, which is to basically get the child to do dental treatment in a dental chair so they don't have to keep going for general anesthetic and never learn how to get good oral health for the continuum of their lives. One thing I do realize with parents is when they come and they talk to me, I talk to them back because I understand their language and I understand exactly what they're going through. And I developed a program that works the span of many kids with special needs, anywhere from anxiety disorders to autism, developmental delays, alcohol syndrome, etc. So I've manipulated my program to work the span of these disorders. And when they talk to me, I understand what they're saying and I can talk back to them. But working with my cohorts, I try and teach them about the program and how to work with these kids and how to work with the parents and how to sort of get control of the situation. But a lot of the medical team does not understand that. And what I try and do is I try and take mentors, other specialists, to come and see what I do, how I interact with them, how I work my program. I've now worked it that these kids can take my program, they can go do ENT jobs, they can go get visual exams, and it takes the, it gives them predictability and it takes the anxiety out of the unknown. And it's kind of like a step-by-step program for them to understand what's going on, not having anxiety and fears, and creating anxiety and fears that parents don't want to take them to their appointments. So I do agree, without kind of getting what I do specifically taking up the time, I do agree that there needs to be something for the medical team to sort of look at and see how to implement strategies to have conversations with parents and how to sort of lessen the anxieties of the children that they're dealing with, or the adults that they're dealing with. Getting into the needs for adults, that's a whole other story, but that needs to be addressed too, because once they leave Children's Hospital, there is nowhere for, in dentistry anyways, there is nowhere for these kids to go. And so that's another conversation that we have to have, and that's something that we're all, I think, in the dental field trying to look at and implement.
Great, thank you. We did have time for one more, and I am actually going to go to the person right here because I haven't heard you speak yet, and I feel their hands are up. People have had a chance, so go ahead. Yeah. Great. Yeah. Did you have your hand up?
I did, but they want go ahead.
I just want to say your original proposition is a really important one, and I should say that the networks of centers of excellence, this is an unpaid pitch, their prime objective is to take the work in academics and move it out into the real world. Right? So hooking up with a network of centers of excellence, and there's a lot of them doing all kinds of things, is they all have knowledge translation, knowledge mobilization tools, and our SPOR, strategy for patient-oriented research, also has that. And critically, it's patient-oriented research, and clinicians are one of the targets, and researchers are one of the targets. That is, when a patient comes to see a clinician, that clinician has to step into the patient's shoes, or that researcher has to step into the patient's shoes. And that's this new dialogue that's going on. And to whatever extent I can help, I think it's a huge turn on the way we do things, but it's absolutely critical. And I'm just happy to put in our knowledge translation efforts into this. So, anyway.
Yeah, we have. Well, this is such a great conversation. We'll go quickly here, and Jake, I know you had your hand up, so if we can keep the comment short, we can definitely come to you too. Great. Go ahead.
Hi, I work for the First Nations Health Authority, and just new to kind of this environment, but one thing that I kind of am observing is that there's kind of some missing components here, and two of them is governance and engagement.
I feel like a lot of the missing pieces I'm hearing is that there's no data. Like you don't have the data to argue with. You don't have the different pieces to show some of those pieces. And you can't get that without engagement from a customer client base. The big piece for our end, First Nations Health Authority, for its time in Canada, we were able to take on the federal administration programs and service delivery because we engaged, and we have 203 communities that we pulled together to say, yeah, no, we want to own it. And now we can actually design our programs and services specifically. So you're talking about a health benefit that First Nations people have is we have Carol here, who is our dental manager, because we said that oral health was a priority for us. In each one of our regions, mental health and wellness is a priority for each one of our regions. But we can go to the government or our partners and say, this is a priority that they've told us. And as their voice, we're addressing it. So what I feel is the better together is really kind of coming together on the community and identify is your community and how do you get that engagement enough to be able to say that you have a voice, because you're going to talk to the government or you're going to talk to all these different pieces. Who are you if you're one of 80 different organizations coming together? So I do like that better best looks kind of idea, but you really got to look at the government's piece and whose voice are you speaking on behalf of. You need to get those people to agree that you will be their voice, and you can't do that unless you together a different way. So,
yes, thank you.
Just
yeah.
One minute. This sentence has two components, and it's probably important to separate them. The second part can be understood by stakeholders, both those who are talking, and all of this was saying about the knowledge translation, transfer, and basically. So, it means that the data already exists, and the question is how can we pass this information to the right person? The first part is more complex. How do we work with researchers, and the we means, I guess, these organizations who are involved with children with neurodevelopmental and intellectual disability? That part is complex because the traditional way of research is that the researchers bring the idea to the field, try to recruit patients and publish results. And working a lot in the community, we found that many patients are frustrated who work with children because they never heard about the research after the research. So there is a complete disconnect between the goal of the researcher and the community that participated in the research. So the good model, I think, and this is why we try to develop a special Olympics, is a partnership where the questions come from the participants in special Olympics, the managers, the coaches, the families, because they have the real questions about their life, their priority, what is important. And the researchers have to be the expert in understanding the questions, translating the question into research question, whether it's feasible or not, and organizing the design to collect the information. But all the work is done for the users, for the people who have the needs. And that's a model which is not the traditional way in research presenting.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I need one more comment.
Sorry,
no, that's okay. Go ahead. It's exciting that you're this engaged. When we planned for this, we're going, okay, so what do we do if nobody wants to sing? This is a better problem to have. Go ahead.
So my other hat is I'm currently a PhD candidate at the University of Victoria in Social Dimensions of Health. And my area is health and families of kids with disabilities. But I'm accessing population health data to do my research, and I don't know if how many people know about population health, and you certainly would, this for. So population health data is province-wide data. There's currently 30 years worth of data started back in 1985 on the use of healthcare by everyone pretty well in the province. excluding First Nations, actually. There's not a lot of data about First Nations, but everyone else. So what I'm doing is I'm looking at healthcare usage of parents and siblings of kids with developmental disabilities. But the next step would be that I would be looking also at the health of kids or and adults with developmental disabilities. And I really think that there is, and you mentioned this in your framework, there's a lack of basic information just on how many people there are in the province who have developmental disabilities, what those developmental disabilities are, and what they're using in terms of healthcare. That information is out there, it just needs to be accessed, and there's certainly a way to access it through Prop Data. So I really think that, and one of the other things I just want to say is a lot of the Stats Canada data does not include people with developmental disabilities. There's whole issues around confidentiality, whether people are able to answer surveys, whether they have the ability to answer surveys depending on the severity of disability and so on. And population data we see doesn't suffer from any of those things because it's anonymized data that physicians are putting in when they see patients. So I don't know if anybody's seen the Atlas on the primary care of adults with developmental disabilities that came out of Ontario 2 years ago, but I think that that's something that we should be working towards in BC, and it's very achievable, and I would like to promote that happening soon. Thank you.
Wonderful. Well, great. What a rich conversation. And your sharing resource actually makes me remember, I have been meaning to mention, as you leave today, there's a table just outside the door that has resources that people who come to the meeting today have brought to share. So if you on the break you haven't stumbled across that table yet, I encourage you to take a look at what's there before you leave today, because there's some really great resources that everyone has brought to share. So now it's my pleasure to introduce to you Wilma Van Hag, who is the mother of Special Olympics athlete Marinka. Marinka is here today as well. Marinka is involved in swimming and soccer, and her mom Wilma also coaches snowshoeing, rhythmic gymnastics, bowling, and sits on the local organizing committee in Prince George. So please warm and welcome Wilma.
Prince George is a great place to live and is considered the hub of the North. I had always thought that Prince George was large enough to have all the amenities until our daughter was diagnosed with the amount of developmental delays and an intellectual disability. This is when I realized that we were living in the North, miles away from services that we needed. There was testing that needed to be done, specialists to see, many of which were in Vancouver at BC Children's Hospital. It was already overwhelming trying to find answers and ways to help her, and now there was the added stress of traveling to an unfamiliar hospital. It was so much easier when a specialist from Vancouver would come to Prince George to see local patients. Not only that, it saved time and the expense of going. We are very lucky to have wonderful doctors in Prince George that care for Marinka. She's not the easiest of patients. Years of tests, examinations, and unknown doctors made it difficult for her to realize that doctors were there to help her. Our family doctor and dentist have been very patient and learned to work with Marinka on her terms. What may take one appointment for one person could take 2 to 3 appointments for her. Doctors spend their time to talk to her, get to know her, build a friendship and a trust. Marinka is terrified of needles, and so any dental work has to be done under anesthesia at the hospital. This can take months or even a year as her appointment gets delayed for various reasons. So I wonder, while we wait, does the problem become larger? Sometimes the small things for anyone else is a huge ordeal for others. Blood tests, for example, are a huge stress point for Marinka. It has been years of struggle to finally find something she is comfortable with. There were clinics that she refused to go to because they would get mad at her. She now goes on her own to a clinic that allows her to do it her way. Do you want to tell them how you do it?
I lay down and then hide my head with my jacket and listen to music.
So by allowing her to come and have some say in what makes her comfortable makes her a better patient. When you are raising children, it is by trial and error. You speak to other parents, schools, sports, etc., and learn from each other. When you have a child with disabilities, it becomes much harder. There are many times when you don't know where to go, what's available, and you just want someone who will listen and understand what you're going through. I have always thought that it would be helpful to have a manual or a website that you can go to specifically designed for parents of children that have disabilities, as well for adults with disabilities, listing the different organizations, where and how to get medical information, financial help advice, funding. I'm quite sure that there are things available that I, along with many others, are not aware of. As a family, we are very active. All our kids were kept busy with sports, music, and dance. Marinka was no exception. When she was young, she was in swim lessons, gymnastics, and youth soccer. It wasn't long before she had a difficult time keeping up with the other kids in generic sports. We wanted to keep sports fun and entertaining for her, so began to look for something different. We knew about Special Olympics and registered her in rhythmic gymnastics when she was 8 years old. This is one of the best decisions we have ever made. It has become a huge part of our lives and of Marinka's life. She attends practices every day and sometimes twice. This has been great as it keeps her active and her weight somewhat under control. Keeping Marinka's weight down has always been a struggle and continues to be. We have had doctors talk about her weight, but so far we have not found any solutions, and it still continues to be something we are working on. My worry is that her weight can lead to medical issues later in life. As parents, we only want what is best for our children and to know that they are happy. As our other children go out into the world to create lives of their own, we wonder what the future holds for Marinka. What is best for her? What is available? What are her options? And where do we find them? Thank you.
Thank you, Wilma and Marinka. Now I want to introduce to you Ashton Steffen. Ashton is the coordinator of health sciences for Special Olympics British Columbia and relatively new to Special Olympics BC after moving here last fall. Before that, she volunteered at the health promotion program for Special Olympics up in the Yukon. So, Ashton.
Many in the medical community have not been trained, nor do they feel comfortable with their knowledge of treating individuals with ID. An Australian study found that 94% of health practitioners were interested in further training in this area. This matches a survey of undergraduate medical students in Ontario that found that 93.3% thought they should have more training than they had received when treating people with ID. 52% of medical deans in the US feel that their graduates are not competent to treat people with ID. It's not all bad news. There is hope. Although surveys conducted by Special Olympics, 84% of healthcare providers felt better prepared to treat people with intellectual disabilities as a result in volunteering with healthy athletes. They just need the exposure, some guidance, and knowledge to improve their comfort and knowledge level. We still need to find solutions to getting people with ID to appropriate medical care. Internal surveys of Special Olympics BC found that 32% of athletes surveyed needed to travel outside their community for medical services some or most of the time. 80% of the athletes at least sometimes found it difficult to understand their doctor's advice, but only 31% were accompanied by someone to their doctor's appointments. Special Olympics BC data also suggests that 50% of athletes visit a medical professional more than 4 times a year, and 12.5% will visit more than 10 times. Data from the US found that visiting a healthy athlete screening, that 66% of Special Olympics athletes were able to get follow-up care and to resolve their dental concerns. That means that 34% left the screening and did not receive the care they needed. There seems to be a disconnect here, and we need to get better access to healthcare. And when there is that access, we need to do more to follow up, either through ensuring someone is there to help interpret medical instructions or to ensure that those instructions are acted on. We also know that people with ID are not always thought of when health initiatives are rolled out. We need to look at that and find ways to address it so that individuals with ID have the same access to health initiatives as everyone else. For example, as was stated earlier, Only 34.3% of women with intellectual disabilities will be screened for cervical cancer versus 66.8% of women without ID. Do caregivers not ask for screenings? Did those conducting the screening not think it's important? Do individuals with ID even know that they should have these screenings? How do we narrow the gap so that people with ID get the same access to quality health care as everyone else? Thank you.
And before we get into the discussion, I want to show a short video of Special Olympics athlete Corey and Judy Lee.
What were your expectations of healthy athletes? What did you know going into healthy athletes?
When you open my mouth, I put four in my mouth.
I don't think we had a lot of expectations. Yeah, I had read up about it.
About my bad one.
We just knew that we had friends of Corey's that were athletes that really wanted to go, and I just wanted Corey to accompany his friends.
How were Corey's previous experiences at the doctor before healthy athletes?
Always really stressful.
And
he needed a lot of reassurance. He was very anxious. They were few and far between. You know, we knew we had to work on it. It was on our list of things that we were trying to get done. The doctors could never take enough time. You know, if Corey refused once, twice, they just accepted it. Like, he had a right to refuse. He was always well presented, well mannered, and then he would just say, "Well, I don't feel like doing that," or I don't have, or really, really quick with, "I don't have a problem." In the healthy promotions, he had his blood pressure taken, and Corey, you want to tell the story about your blood pressure? Who took your blood pressure? A man wrapped something around your arm. Which arm? He did both, right?
He did one
after the other, and it was really positive. You know, he showed some initial resistance, and he surprised me. He did it, and since then, the doctors had an easier time getting blood pressures. You know, we've gone to the doctor twice since then, and it's just been a lot more effortless. And then the other stations were dental, and he blew me away at dental. Based on his previous experiences, which were all under general anesthetic and non-compliance, and just sort of not even full disclosure about what had happened. For me to see him letting people examine his mouth with instruments in his mouth, with fingers in his mouth, flossing his mouth, putting fluoride in, it was just, I was just running around going, "I can't believe it. I can't believe that's the same person that has had all these failed attempts." You could see he was a little anxious, but he wanted to please these volunteers, and the volunteers were so nice. Well, at Healthy Feet, we discovered a problem that I wasn't aware of. I was actually really surprised and felt really shocked. And the nice thing was that the people there were so professional. They were so reassuring. They offered me, you know, told me not to feel bad, and said we can take care of this and it's easy and it happens to a lot of people.
This
is what you can do. And they offered me an appointment. I'll tell the funny thing is that we had the wrong shoe size for 3 years. And healthy athletes measure his feet. Something as simple as measuring his feet. We just assumed because he had some shoes that were a different size, and then all the other shoes after that were that size. You remember when they measured your feet? They told you to put your feet in a thing, and they told you what size foot you were. Size feet are you now?
I'm not 28.
You're not a 28. And then the last station we visited was hearing. And actually, Corey, you know, had so many successes, built upon successes all that morning, that actually I turned around and he was gone. He went off by himself to hearing tests. That's huge, too, because Corey doesn't let anybody put anything on his ears. Mm-hmm. He doesn't usually sit still for very long, as you can see. And he doesn't usually comply. And he usually needs me fairly close to him to help interpret sometimes, too, because his language, he does have a speech impairment. But no, they came back and said he was fine. They even took him out to a mobile. It wasn't even the same building. I couldn't believe it.
It was a truck on wheels.
It was a truck on wheels.
There were two of them. One
over there.
So again, Healthy Athletes is our lens into all of this. It's the program we've had the most experience to. But what I think it highlights there is actually a common experience that many athletes have when they come to the Healthy Athlete programs, which is people who have time to talk to them about what's going on, and people have a little bit of additional training on how to work with a person with an intellectual disability. And I have to say, I don't think what we do in Healthy Athletes is magic in any way that can't be replicated somewhere else. We have volunteers who come in, and usually they start the day a little bit nervous, having not worked with people with disabilities before. And by the end of the day, by having just a chance to have exposure to working with this population, by giving a few tools about communication, about talking to the person instead of to their parent, or ways that you can communicate with someone who's not verbal, they leave empowered. They end up having stronger, better experiences with the athletes that they come in contact with. And so that's something that we would really love to see expanded into the larger medical community, because as we've heard from so many people today, it's something that's certainly lacking. So that feeds into our next discussion, if you could put the questions up on the screen. So for health professional education, you know, how are those who are in this field, how do they access education about how to work with people with ID? That's both people who are in medical schools and people who have graduated and are working out in our communities. And how can we get that information out to them? And then, I guess that's the second one, is there for people who are training to enter? No, go back to the, sorry, the one before. And you know, how do we do those who are training to learn about how to work with people with ID, and how do we get the information to them? So, I'll open it up for thoughts about this. What things could we either individually or collectively do to start working on this issue? And I guess we'll start first with a thumbs up, thumbs sideways, thumbs down of, is this something that you think that is important and that we should be taking on? Thumbs up, thumbs sideways, thumbs down? Okay, thumbs up across the room. Beautiful, that's great. So I open it up to all of you to, yeah, Johnny.
I think building on some of the current strength in this area, knowing Dr. Lisi is in the room, the practice support program, which is a mandatory continuing medical education program for practicing physicians in BC, is a great example of something that was funded by the joint committees and has widespread engagement within the physician population in BC. Recently, from the perspective of being better able to respond to mental health, is a mandatory component of the practice support program focused on child and adolescent and adult mental health. And I'm not sure if intellectual disabilities is included in that curriculum, but I think we'll connect with doctors at BC. You've got a ready-made infrastructure, and I think it's undergoing reform currently. So,
yeah, that sounds like a great opportunity.
So I want to pick up on a number of comments that have been made throughout the day, and maybe make an outside-the-box suggestion. So I think the way health professionals first of all, engage with medical education, it's very unlikely you're going to get more than an hour in some curriculum in a medical school to deal with this. And that's not going to equip health professionals to deal with it, nor is it going to equip all the health professionals that you actually need to engage, because it's not just physicians, it's dentists and others. So probably a more pragmatic and useful approach would be to connect those who are interested in supporting individuals with intellectual disability and learning from people who already do their practice in this way by creating a network of individual health professionals who can learn from each other about the ways in which to interact with individuals, who can train each other in what they've learned on the ground, and can connect to others who actually have that experience. And so I don't know who it is that runs your Healthy or who are involved in assessing people, but that's a good place to start. You've got people who have on-the-ground experience of working with individuals with intellectual disability, getting them through a diagnostic process, and those individuals can share their learning with others who are interested in learning. So creating some sort of an organic network where people can share what they know is probably going to have a lot more impact. Not only share what they know, but share who they know when they encounter an individual and that individual needs something else that they don't have the expertise to provide. If you build a strong network, then they're going to know, hey, I know so-and-so who does that kind of work in ENT or dental or whatever it is, right? So it's helping the practitioners who are keen to work and support individuals well to do that and to connect with others would probably be a more pragmatic approach than trying to create a curriculum and squeezing it into something that's already too full, that many people will not care about, but those who do care would come together, and I suspect that the people who will care the most are the health professionals who already deal with individuals with intellectual disability in their family as a starting place. So helping you know who to call when your dental patient actually needs to see somebody who's going to look at their eyes. Do you know who to call? No, probably not.
Thank you. With great respect, I think I disagree with that concept. It's a good one, we can include it, but I'm more inclined to follow the direction that I think health has taken with respect to Indigenous peoples here in British Columbia. A year ago or so, the university, I guess, had presentations on the start of evolution to people who contributed to the goal of raising, I forget, $1 billion or something for advancing education at UBC. And one of the speakers was a woman who won a program assessment, and her idea was that in the Faculty of Medicine, every program, every course being taught had to include some portion of its curriculum content on Indigenous needs, because there were, they found systemic barriers to treatment that were not being considered by medicine. I believe that's the step we have to take. There is no reason that treatments should be restricted to only pediatric medicine for people with disabilities. Sadly, our family members do not automatically resolve from their disabilities at age 19. And so the idea that we don't train most of our doctors to ensure they're able to treat the needs, meet the needs, certainly the communication needs of people with disabilities is completely wrong. And so that's an area. For example, the patient-oriented research that the gentleman over here spoke about, again, that material, I analyzed it this recently in November because a grant of money was given from the federal government to our provincial government to enhance that. But none of it is directed towards research involving specifically people with disabilities and how you would communicate their needs. Certainly zero involves oral healthcare. None of the advisors that are brought into the project, of course, once again, none of them have any oral medicine, oral healthcare, anything to do with systemic body issues. So I want to take this one step to make this one. I promise I won't take any more airtime today. I've talked so much. But in the business case that the Minister of Health insisted be written with agreement from the Faculty of Dentistry before it even considered the issue of access to care in a specialized clinic for those people who couldn't get into hospital but needed to, for dental treatment, and in my personal view, it shouldn't be that we in community are forced to write a business case dealing with a health issue. It really should be the health ministry coming up with it. But in the course of writing that, I provided a section on case histories of people who have struggled and suffered, seriously suffered, because of the lack of access to care. And I mentioned earlier that there are, health complications that arise from periodontal disease. The first case study, if you want a copy, I've left a business card, a couple of examples of the business case out there. Please feel free, be in touch, I'll send you a copy. The first case study involved a young woman who had serious problems with dental decay. Her family could not for her access care because she had a rare genetic deletion that created many complications. Her teeth seriously suffered. When she developed a problem this fall and the paramedics tried to insert a breathing tube, two of her teeth actually broke off. That's the level of a problem. Shortly after Christmas, she died. She was 30. Now, folks, we're not talking about, you know, cosmetic dentistry here. So people's lives are at risk. I'm sorry to focus on oral, but I think it is for many of the systemic health issues that are facing our family members, if they can't get knowledgeable care providers to pay attention, to take the time, to listen, to have multiple appointments when necessary, well, we are being unserved by those people being trained to serve us. So I'd like it to be as common for them to receive, you know, some expertise for disability as for as tiny as it is, but you've got to start, I think, in Indigenous needs, and they should be seen.
So great. So one of the things that I was thinking about as you were talking was, so I live in Rochester, New York, which is just across the lake from Toronto, and the medical school there, the University of Rochester Medical Center, is looking at how to bring education into their curriculum for their medical students. Not as necessarily a silo from, you know, like let's just infuse this additional thing, but thinking about all of the different populations that the skills they'd be building for those practitioners would overlap with. So we know that there's a large aging population who are going to have similar needs that people who have ID in terms of issues that come with dementia, of how do you communicate, how do you get information from people who aren't necessarily able to communicate with you that well. There are similarities in working with people for whom English is not a first language. There's similarities in many different types of population that the skill sets that you would want to develop for someone working with people with ID would actually benefit many different populations. And so that type of a sell has been an easier one to medical schools than just coming at it specifically from a disability perspective. And so can we go to the next slide just to keep the conversation going? And I know there were some hands up that I didn't get to, so as we move forward in this conversation, thinking about inclusion of people with ID in the medical system, but also in our government and non-governmental organizations, I think the main question here is, how do we get people with ID to be on the forefront of conversations instead of an afterthought or even a non-thought? So how do we promote inclusion of people with IDs in all programs in our communities through non-governmental organizations, through outreach activities? And how do we get how do we engage with government to make the priorities that we have for this population be part of their system? Hand back here first.
I think I'm going to tee up on what Tim said earlier is, you know, getting advocacy, people voting is critical. Having information for people to access so they know what their rights are. They know that they can access alternative communication when they go to medical appointments and access that support. And also, I know that McMaster University has done some videos around self-advocates explaining what they need from healthcare professionals that are great, and you know, replicating that, you know, more and more and more, so that that people can advocate for themselves and aren't relying on others to advocate for them.
Thank you. This table.
I think for this group, and it links back to Dr. Diane Feingood's commentary, it's really, I think, understanding the strategic policy context that we're operating within, right? And currently, I think government is grappling with a whole set of population health needs, including a public health emergency around overdoses and addictions and mental health. And of course, there's very real pressing health needs for the population at the heart of our conversation today. And so I think back to Diane's comments, or Dr. Feingood's comments, it's around presenting that there's a complexity here, and we need to engage with that complexity in the policy positioning that needs to be put forward for consideration by government. And I think that requires a very strong literacy as to what the current provincial government's priorities are. So the Ministry of Children and Family Development has a whole set of priorities around complex care, The Ministry of Health has a whole set of strategic priorities around primary care reform, massive primary care reform underway currently, wanting to respond to the needs of rural, remote populations. So I think strong literacy in this room, and maybe it's through coalition building and getting to know the sector. I mean, I've learned lots this morning and hope to engage more with this sector. Building those necessary relationships for cost sharing, and then really understanding the strategic policy context within which we need to operate. And a lot of that is intersectional thinking, that health is a holistic thing. We don't walk into encounter healthcare systems with discrete parts of our bodies and our minds. We're all interconnected. So our mental health is interconnectedly connected to oral health, to physical health. And whether you're living with an intellectual disability or a physical disability, there are compounding effects to that. So I think what is required is complexity thinking, and for this group to have a very strong understanding of what government's priorities are, and that you in lots of ways can serve government priorities, keeping people out of emergency rooms, keeping people out of acute and tertiary care, which are very expensive items for government to manage, and ensuring that early intervention and prevention are key parts of those policy priorities, I think will ensure that the policy asks of this group have relevancy for decision makers.
My solution might seem a little bit simplistic, but I also wonder, as a person that doesn't have a brother, a sister, a mother, a father with a developmental disability, I came into this world through community building, and I didn't end up thinking about a person with a developmental disability. And a person that was so connected to community, and I wasn't thinking that, so many people are not thinking that. So I think that might be our starting point. If we can just mash up together and get to know each other and learn all of that, that's where I think our starting point comes, where that doctor who now ends up knowing that child, adult, that happens to have a developmental disability, they're gonna walk in to that room with that patient in a very different way. And I know we create a lot of these programs where we're trying to create inclusion. And often it's those of us that are already involved in the sector that step in and think that we're doing that. And I think other things need to be created outside of that. And one, it's not a perfect solution, but there's something that's called Best Buddies. And it started off at universities, it's now at colleges and high schools as well. And it's for those people that don't have a brother or sister or don't know anybody. You start hanging out, and I think we need to have that shift of the brain and the shift of the lens for all of this to happen. So that person that works in government, they know how, maybe not how mom or dad feel, but they know how it feels. That's where I think we need to start.
Thank you. So at this point, I think we can, we aren't going to be able to get to everybody because we're running short on time. So what I will ask is if you had comments or thoughts that you didn't get to write them down into the documents that we're going to be collecting at the end of the day so that they don't get lost. But we're also going to have a chance to talk as a group about next steps. So there may be an opportunity to get some of your ideas into that. So in the next step, you all have received a copy of the framework document. One of the things that Special Olympics is trying to do is get endorsements of that framework. So if you haven't already and if you're interested, please get in touch with Special Olympics British Columbia and submit a statement from your organization or from you as an individual supporting the framework. That would be very helpful to the work that we're doing. You also have a couple of documents, a survey document and a next step document. Please make sure to fill those out and give them to us before the end of the day so that we are able to capture a lot of what happened here and think about next steps together. We're also thinking that we might like to get people together from their respective fields or based on interest to meet as a whole periodically. And we want to have a chance to talk about next steps as well. So I guess what I'll do is we have a short video to close up with, and then I'll invite Dan back up on the stage and we can talk collectively about
what our next steps are coming out of here, because there's been such great conversation and such great ideas shared. I really want to make sure that we don't lose the momentum that we've built today.
How many of you are completely comfortable with calling yourselves a leader? See, I've asked that question all the way across the country, and everywhere I ask it, no matter where, there's always a huge portion of the audience that won't put up their hand. And I've come to realize that we have made leadership into something bigger than us. We made it into something beyond us. We made it about changing the world. And we've taken this title of leader and we treat it as if it's something that one day we're going to deserve. But to give it to ourselves right now means a level of arrogance or cockiness that we're not comfortable with. And I worry sometimes that we spend so much time celebrating amazing things that hardly anybody can do that we've convinced ourselves that those are the only things we're celebrating. And we start to devalue the things that we can do every day. And we start to take moments where we truly are a leader and we don't let ourselves take credit for it and we don't let ourselves feel good about it. And I've been lucky enough over the last 10 years to work with some amazing people who have helped me redefine leadership in a way that I think has made me happier. And with my short time today, I just want to share with you the one story that is probably most responsible for that redefinition. I went to a school on a little school called Mount Allison University in Sackville, New Brunswick. And on my last day there, a girl came up to me and she said, "I remember the first time that I met you." And then she told me a story that happened 4 years earlier. She said, "On my day before I started university, I was in the hotel room with my mom and my dad, and I was so scared and so convinced that I couldn't do this, that I wasn't ready for university, that I just burst into tears. And my mom and my dad were amazing. They were like, 'Look, we know you're scared, but let's just go tomorrow. Let's go to the first day. And if at any point you feel as if you can't do this, that's fine. Just tell us, we will take you home. We love you no matter what.'" And she said, "So I went the next day and I was standing in line getting ready for registration, and I looked around and I just knew I couldn't do it. I knew I wasn't ready. I knew I had to quit." And she says, "I made that decision, and as soon as I made it, there was this incredible feeling of peace that came over me. And I turned to my mom and my dad to tell them that we needed to go home. And just at that moment, you came out of the student union building wearing the stupidest hat I have ever seen in my life. It was awesome. And you had a big sign promoting ShineRM, which is Students Fighting Cystic Fibrosis, a charity I've worked with for years. And you had a bucket full of lollipops. And you were walking along and you were handing the lollipops out to people in line and talking about ShineRM. And all of a sudden, you got to me, and you just stopped, and you stared. It was creepy." This girl right here knows exactly what I'm talking about. "And then you looked at the guy next to me, and you smiled, and you reached in your bucket, you pulled out a lollipop, and you held it out to him. And you said, 'You need to give a lollipop to the beautiful woman standing next to you.' And she said, 'I have never seen anyone get more embarrassed faster in my life.' He turned beet red, and he wouldn't even look at me. He just kind of held the lollipop out like this. And I felt so bad for this dude that I took the lollipop. And as soon as I did, you got this incredibly severe look on your face and you looked at my mom and my dad and you said, 'Look at that. Look at that. First day away from home and already she's taking candy from a stranger.'" And she said, "Everybody lost it. 20 feet in every direction, everyone started to howl. And I know this is cheesy and I don't know why I'm telling you this, but in that moment when everyone was laughing, I knew that I shouldn't quit. I knew that I was where I was supposed to be and I knew that I was home. And I haven't spoken to you once in the 4 years since that day, but I heard that you were leaving. And I had to come up and tell you that you've been an incredibly important person in my life, and I'm gonna miss you. Good luck." And she walks away, and I'm flattened. And she gets about 6 feet away, she turns around and smiles and goes, "You should probably know this too. I'm still dating that guy 4 years later." A year and a half after I moved to Toronto, I got an invitation to their wedding. Here's the kicker, I don't remember that. I have no recollection of that moment, and I've searched my memory banks because that is funny and I should remember doing it, and I don't remember it. And that was such an eye-opening, transformative moment for me to think that maybe the biggest impact I'd ever had on anyone's life, a moment that had a woman walk up to a stranger 4 years later and say, "You've been an incredibly important person in my life," was a moment that I didn't even remember. How many of you guys have a lollipop moment, a moment where someone said something or did something that you feel fundamentally made your life better? All right. How many of you have told that person they did it? See, why not? We celebrate birthdays where all you have to do is not die for 365 days. And yet we let people who have made our lives better walk around without knowing it. And every single one of you, every single one of you has been the catalyst for a lollipop moment. You have made someone's life better by something that you said or that you did. And if you think you haven't, think about all the hands that didn't go back up when I asked that question. You're just one of the people who hasn't been told. But it is so scary to think of ourselves as that powerful. It can be frightening to think that we can matter that much to other people. Because as long as we make leadership something bigger than us, as long as we keep leadership something beyond us, as long as we make it about changing the world, we give ourselves an excuse not to expect it every day from ourselves and from each other. Marianne Williamson said, "Our greatest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our greatest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. It is our light and not our darkness that frightens us." And my call to action today is that we need to get over that. We need to get over our fear of how extraordinarily powerful we can be in each other's lives. We need to get over it so we can move beyond it. And our little brothers and our little sisters, and one day our kids, or our kids right now, can watch us start to value the impact we can have on each other's lives more than money and power and titles and influence. We need to redefine leadership as being about lollipop moments. How many of them we create, how many of them we acknowledge, how many of them we pay forward, and how many of them we say thank you for. Because we've made leadership about changing the world, and there is no world. There's only 6 billion understandings of it. And if you change one person's understanding of it, one person's understanding of what they're capable of, one person's understanding of how much people care about them, one person's understanding of how powerful an agent for change they can be in this world, you've changed the whole thing. And if we can understand leadership like that, I think if we can redefine leadership like that, I think we can change everything. And it's a simple idea, but I don't think it's a small one. And I want to thank you all so much for letting me share it with you today.
So now I want to turn it over to Dan to wrap things up for the day. I think we'll talk first a little bit about the lollipop moment and then some of the larger things that we can do collectively.
So we have a couple people that are going to give you a couple of lollipops. The dietitians and nutritionists in the room say you can't eat them. So what we would like you to do is take one of those lollipops and put it on your desk. And every time you look at that lollipop, we want you to think about what could you do. What could you do to make somebody's life a little bit better? You don't have to change the policy on this. You just might have to talk to somebody about an issue that they're having. You just might have to go for a walk with somebody. You might have to give somebody directions on how to find some information. So we want you to keep one lollipop for that. We'd like you to keep a second lollipop and give it to somebody who's going to help you. Help you and talk to them about how do you make change? How do you influence behavior? How do you bring somebody along so that you and the second person that you've already brought into your sphere, how do the two of you now set about to do some things and make some change? So when we were talking today, we talked a little bit about short-term and long-term. That's not to mean that short-term and long-term have different levels of importance. What we mean is there's some things we can turn around today and have very quickly. So for example, we may be able to turn to Canadian Mental Health and work with some of their data in very short period of time, or some of their information packages in very short period of time. We may be able to have that so others can use it. But there are going to be things that we may start today, we're just not going to have an answer today. And you know, we still have to push on those, but they will take a little bit longer in terms of getting our information so that every doctor, every dentist, every nurse, every person graduating from kinesiology, every one of those people who have the ability to impact the lives of people with an intellectual disability around health, every one of those is going to get a little bit of training. And it may only be an hour at the start. It may be something like the chartered accountants where they have to do X number of hours of professional development. Well, maybe we get, you know, some information in there that's part of it. We don't know what it's going to look like, but we know we have to change that. We have also heard a lot of things today about, you know, we should be connecting with this group or we should be talking to this person. I'll be honest with you, as Lois said earlier, we didn't know some of you people even existed out there. You know, so we work on our own little silo as well. And so quite often what would happen is we would reach out to one of you and you'd say, well, you've invited so-and-so, haven't you? We have now, you know, but it was that whole process that we didn't know half of you in the room. And so we need that help to say, you know what, there's a whole group out there of people we have to get involved with. The challenges around connecting with people are very real. As I said earlier, we only have a small percentage of the population in the Special Olympic program. as does other groups. We all connect with different people, and sometimes there's an overlap. But even if we did a fantastic job, the best job ever, of getting out to every person, every athlete, every parent, every caregiver, every coach, and gave them all the information, that's still only a small percentage of the people. We need to find a way that we can be delivering that message constantly, consistently, to every single person in the province who either has an intellectual disability or everybody who in turn has the ability to get involved in that person's life one way or the other, whether that's through I can help change a policy or I can help provide a program or whatever it is. We need a way that we can communicate better together. Our goal today was not to solve all the problems. As we said earlier, they're very, very complex. Our goal was not to solve the problem. Our goal today was merely to start a conversation and to see if other people felt as frustrated as we did. But also to find out if others are prepared to do something about this. So we could all say, you know, that was a great discussion today, walk out of the room and forget about it and not do anything. Or we can all commit to doing something. And it could be a lollipop moment. It doesn't have to change the world. It could be just that little piece where you reach out to somebody else and inform them of what the challenge are. Or it could be something massive that you want to get together and you want to help create. We talked about awareness. Maybe there needs to be a whole awareness campaign leading up into the federal or the provincial election or something, you know, like to educate people. We heard about we need to get individuals voting in that, but we need people to understand what some of the issues are from this population. And I agree fully. You cannot have great mental health, great nutrition, great athletic ability if you can't afford it, if you have no place to live, if you are in constant pain because your teeth hurt. So there's a lot we have to do. Tim said something about there used to be a person in government that was their role, and that's their role to help government stay attuned to what some of the issues were, but how to coordinate things within government. And that's one of the things in the framework document that we were recommending. We got to get back to that because government is an important partner in this, and we need somebody in the system so that when they're talking about a new program, they can say, have you thought about people with intellectual disabilities? Or there's a great resource out here. You don't have to recreate it. Let's go bring them in. But we need somebody who that's their job dedicated toward doing that. On the forms that you have, there are some questions for you about what do you think? Do you want to stay involved? Do you want to keep this discussion going? Do you want to stay involved? Like, for example, do we want all of those who are interested in working on weight management to meet together? All those people who are interested in working on policy to work together? Those who want to look at technology or research or teeth or ears or eyes? Do we want to get them all together to start focusing on their particular area and then convene back every so often? I don't know what every so often is, but convene back to say, here's where we're getting on that. Do we want to become a little more formalized and say, as a group, let's start bringing more people in. We got 70 today. Let's get 150. Let's get 200. Let's get 1,000. Let's, you know, mobilize the population and those people in here and make some changes. And so we've got about 5 minutes. If any thoughts, are we on the right direction? Are we on the wrong direction? Is there anything that we said in closing that concerns you? Or do you have different ideas on the way we should be going? What do we do? Any thoughts, comments, or?
I was just thinking, this past 2 years at PHSA, they made it mandatory for people who work at Beast Children's Hospital or VGH, they had to take an Indigenous course that's an 8-hour module. And personally, I had no idea about the history of Indigenous people. I had no idea what they'd encountered. And there was a lot of information that was brought to the forefront for me and my colleagues that when we treat them, we see them, you know, in the dental setting or a healthcare setting, you get a different perspective, and you get a perspective into their lives and their history and what they've gone through. And just listening to what we're all talking about, I'm kind of thinking in my head, when not doing a module for people with intellectual disabilities, that's maybe made necessary for the healthcare professionals to watch, maybe not 8 hours, but maybe a short, you know, mandatory video that other healthcare professionals can sort of see what's needed and how to interact, and just sort of give an introductory. It's maybe somewhere to start, because I think what they did with the Indigenous module was a great asset to a bunch of us. Maybe we could do something that could be, you know, just as impactful for the special needs community.
I think that's a great example of some of the work that we've done with First Nations Health Authority. It's because, back to my earlier comments about the governance piece, we have a tripartite relationship with the federal government and the provincial government, and we've been able to get at some of these issues that you guys are talking about. And so I feel like there's a learning that can happen on some of the pieces and the steps that the First Nations here in BC have done to own our own health and wellness journey and actually address some of these priorities for us. I would say we sit at the table leadership council with each of the CEOs of every health authority, and on the agenda we continue to drive First Nations issues. And so one of the SANIS program that you're talking about is one of the resulting outcomes that happened because of that work that we've been able to do there. So I really can't underscore enough that engagement piece, where we are able to bring to that table, even though we're not showing up in a lot of the data, that we have an engagement with our people to say mental health is the number one priority in each one of their regions. And nobody can deny that because we bring that voice to that table. So therefore, the primary health care who is tasked to deliver the services to all of our people in primary health, which we don't actually have programs or services in, we partner with them to say, how are you going to do a better job treating our people? So instead of kind of being that siloed extra department on the side or the resources, we're actually looking at some of the different pieces where when the province is doing an oral health strategy, we're ensuring we're hardwired into it. We're not like a side piece into it. So when you're going to have a strategy on mental health, but the strategies and the pieces on primary care, we're not going to be, oh yeah, in an Aboriginal health piece. We actually want to be in the big picture. So those are some of the kind of pieces that I feel like we can do some knowledge transfer in pieces. We had commitment from each one of the CEOs to implement cultural safety and humility, because our people don't access the system. We have had terrible history with the system, and we don't trust the system, which is some of the similar pieces that I hear from the groups here working with people with intellectual disabilities, is that the system interaction is just sucks. So to be able to move it to a place where you're actually getting a commitment from the people responsible to do these pieces to say, okay, cultural safety and humility, we have to think about that. That pointy end of the wedge is going to open it up for cultural safety and humility for other nations and other, like you talk about immigrants and other marginalized and vulnerable groups to come in under that same piece to say we need to address some of these things. So I just think that there's some beneficial learning pieces that we can keep working on there.
Just going to take an opportunity to give a little commercial plug. I want to recognize Renee over here in the corner, who's sitting silently. Renee is with Sobeys, and Sobeys, Safeway, Thrifty Foods are a huge employer of people with intellectual disabilities across the country. And I'd like to just give Renee a couple minutes to talk about this new initiative that they're working on.
Really enjoying the conversation, and I come from a really different perspective in the room today as a community partner, as a corporate partner. And about a year ago, we were looking for a national partner for our company that was reflective of our business and our company and our purpose. That was grassroots and in a lot of the communities where 1,200 stores and employees live and work. And we partnered up with Special Olympics, but we partnered up to really focus in around nutrition education and food access specifically within the movement across the country. And it's been a year of a lot of meeting and talking and taking things slow, which sometimes can be challenging. But what we've landed on is a series of lesson plans or curriculum focused on key topics related to nutrition education that's being delivered across the country to start in some key markets. And what's really fun about it is we're actually training, starting tomorrow night is our first night, but we're training 120 employees who will actually be delivering all of those lesson plans out to groups of athletes, caregivers, and coaches. They're not nutritionists, so it is very basic information and a lot of it reminders, but a big part of it is actually having that dialogue with the athletes and really seeing what need we can help serve as well within Special Olympics. We did the pilots just on Saturday for about 9 hours and tested them out, and it was great. We actually had caregivers turn into us and say, "I did not know that." So they're learning a lot about just, you know, portion control and myths about food and the importance of hydration and a few quick and easy recipes to be able to actually do. And the athletes were just so excited because it was tailored information specific to people with intellectual disabilities. The language was applicable, good, easy tools to take back. So for us, we're learning a huge amount, and we see already the opportunity to be able to take those resources that are being developed for Special Olympics, and then actually one day, once we actually do them for a little while, being able to share them with other organizations who also work with people with intellectual disabilities. And their application probably has a much wider reach than just with Special O. But part of the partnership is actually, that we've talked about, is, you know, creating a better food policy. That's one of the commitments over the next 3 years, working with Special O and creating a better food policy for competitions and meets, seeing if we can actually create some sort of a digital tool for the Special O movement, whether it is a website or an app or something that would also have tools and information too. So it's really interesting for me to be able to hear all of this knowledge in the room, reaffirming that we're on the right track in terms of what we're doing as a partner. And I just wanted to say too, thanks for including me today, Dan. There's two or three pages full of notes, and it was great to hear all the different voices. And if we can help be at the table and connect some of the resources that we have in the community as well, then we'd love to be part of it. Thanks.
So I think one of our challenges is to find progressive companies who are willing to get engaged with our population and invite them in. And as we talk to Sobeys and you know, get them involved, perhaps we can use them to reach out to some of their partners to expand. So the more we can connect with people, I think the better we will be. We promised you that you would be out of here at noon. It's now noon. We would like to ensure that everybody completes those two documents that were in your package and either leave them on the table or give them to one of our Special Olympics individuals around the room. We do want to just thank Special Olympics International, Ali and her team, as well as the Golisano Foundation who funded today's meeting. And the Golisano Foundation, I think, have committed $25 million to improve the health of people with intellectual disabilities. And it's a sizable amount of money, so the kinds of things that we're discussing here today are going to be happening worldwide in an effort to change the conversation about health of people with intellectual disabilities. I hope everybody will stay involved in some way, and I thank each and every one of you for coming out today. And we will be around for a little bit if you have specific questions or thoughts. Love to talk to you. Otherwise, we will be back in touch with all of you at some point to harass and get you involved again. Thank you.